dear life sir.
Hello. Please proceed with the introductory remarks. Good morning, Dr. Firoz. Good morning, Dr. Firoz.
Good morning, Ajay. Hi, everyone.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome you all to yet another scientific extravaganza. We have in past quite a lot of discussion on vascular anastomosis and its complication, but in no conferences or ACMEs, ureteroneostostomy has been touched in detail. Today, we are going to speak more on ureteroneostostomy and its complication, how it is being managed by a galaxy of experts. We have got 6 experts and 10 eminent transplant surgeons from across the country. The whole concept of this session was curated by Dr. Ajay Oswal, and he have taken all the pain to select all the faculties and the topics for this session. With this, we start the session, and over to you, Ajay sir, for further proceeding.
Good morning, everyone, respected teachers and dear friends. The only humble request I want to make is stick to time and stick to topic. Let us proceed. Let us straight away go to the first debate, that is whether you will select a given diabetic donor or not. I will present the case in minimum words. So this is a female who is a non-diabetic for last 5 years, being evaluated as a donor for her brother, who is 58 years on dialysis for 2 years, biopsy proven diabetic kidney disease, and their mother also has diabetes mellitus. The donor has diabetes since last 5 years, maintained on one drug, no insulin. Her BMI is 27.2 kg per meter square. Her HbA1c currently is 6.9. There is no other abnormality connected to the diabetes. Sonography, GFR scan, everything is normal. She has marginal dyslipidemia. 2D echo is normal. The question to two eminent debaters, Dr. Mrinal and Dr. Sanjay, is, will you accept her as a kidney donor? So Dr. Mrinal, you have chosen to defend, to accept this donor. Please proceed.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, teachers, seniors, and dear colleagues. So I would first like to thank Dr. Ajay for giving me this opportunity to take part in this debate. And I'll be speaking in favor of why we can accept this particular case as a donor.
Share your screen, sir.
Yeah.
Mrinal, full screen.
Yes, sir.
Slide show.
Yeah. So, is it visible?
Yes, please proceed.
Yeah. So, I'll be speaking in favor of why we can accept this particular patient as our donor. And we all know transplant being the treatment of choice, and there's a huge disparity in numbers given the demand and supply, especially in India, where 90% transplants are performed live. And so that's why the criteria, expanded criteria donor and marginal live donors have a value, in especially in India. So I would like to start with a disclaimer that no other medically fit and blood group compatible donor was available in the family, and this was the only donor that we can work with. So what are the issues that we have with diabetic donors when it comes to living donors, the short-term and the long-term harm, and of course the graft functioning and survival either in deceased or in living donors. So this was a study which was published in 2019 only. It was a histopathological study where they found out in diseased kidney, 26 patients were diabetic, and they did a post-perfusion biopsy. And no diabetic nephropathy changes were observed in 20 of them. And the other six also had mild. When followed up, those 20, they continued to have 9 out of 12, no diabetic nephropathy changes. And in the other three, they had mild and early changes, but then all three aspirants also developed diabetes. And in the group that had early diabetic nephropathy changes, there were reversal of diabetic nephropathy changes in actually three patients. And there was mild progression in the other two. So saying that diabetic nephropathy changes can actually reverse or remain stable in a non-diabetic patient especially. So this was a mini review, and it stated that although the graft failure with diabetic kidney had an inferior graft survival, but the absolute hazard ratio, absolute difference was small, and there was no difference in patient survival. And actually, Mohan et al. Showed that it was better to take kidneys from standard criteria donor with diabetes, which were better than kidneys from extended criteria donor without diabetes. So this was an interesting study published by Cohen, in which they studied recipients in discordant pair. One kidney was given to a diabetic, and other kidney from the same donor was given to a non-diabetic. And they came up with interesting observations, especially that the diabetic donor kidney, when grafted in a non-diabetic recipient, it actually fared better than a non-diabetic donor in a diabetic recipient. So diabetes doesn't give a disadvantage when it comes to the donor. And of course, the perfect survival was in a non-diabetic donor in a non-diabetic recipient. So what are the risks in donors? Given if we study the natural history of diabetic nephropathy, so only 40% patients actually convert from normal albuminuria to renal failure. And when they do so, they take a median of 25 to 30 years before they from the time of initial diagnosis to the diagnosis of ESRD. So a long journey to travel. Silvero studied these GFRs in solitary kidney with diabetes and without diabetes, and they found that the GFRs were similar in the follow-up, and in fact better than one kidney GFR in patients with two kidneys with type 2 diabetes. Ibrahim published, and they studied post-donation diabetes, and they found that diabetes was not associated with any increased risk of ESRD in their book. Although diabetes accounts for half of ESRD cases in general population, only in 12 to 22% of ESRD cases were attributed to DM after donation. And the development of diabetes resulted in a GFR decline only in a group where there were both hypertension and proteinuria present. To make my point, this table from the same study. So there was hardly any difference, no significant difference between GFR between 7 years prior to DM diagnosis between diabetic and non-diabetic. And even after DM diagnosis, the only group that had a significant difference was where they were both hypertension and proteinuria, more so with proteinuria. So the other confounding factor with diabetes, which leads to increased risk of ESRD, is obesity. The NIH defines it as BMI more than 30. And it is after controlling for multiple risk factors, the only potential modifier factor is obesity. And compared to non-obese, it has a hazard ratio of 1.86, 1.9-fold risk of ESRD post-donation. And for each unit increase in BMI above 27, there was an associated 7% increase in risk of ESRD. Now, there are some studies from Japan. Yes, sir. Just 30 seconds, sir. So there are many studies from Japan where they actually take diabetic donors. They are more liberal in taking patients with impaired glucose tolerance and diabetes. And this was a study published by Okamoto, and they studied that the mortality rates at even after 20 years were similar in both the groups. and none of the patients in diabetes mellitus group had severe diabetic complication or end-stage renal disease. So these are the five patients which had already been diagnosed DM before they gave, before they donated, and the creatinine and the BMI were similar in both. So what would be my advice for the donor? I would like to achieve these following targets in the donor: HbA1c less than 6.5, correction of dyslipidemia, BMI preferably less than 25, and understanding that he would strictly follow up with us and monitor with us. And the measures would be exercise, diet, loss of weight, better glycemic control, informed consent about his risk and what he's getting into, what are the risks involved, and his long-term prognosis, and which can be done through extensive and thorough counseling about and the need to comply with medical advice and healthy lifestyle in future. Thank you.
Jay, your mic is off. You're muted.
I now request Dr. Sanjay Kolte to defend why he cannot take this donor. Sanjay, please.
Yeah, somebody has to, I think, Mrinal has to stop sharing.
Yeah, I did, I think. I just did. Is it still being shared, sir? I don't know.
I'm trying. Yes. Am I visible now?
Please proceed.
So, कहीं मकबर ही ना हो जाए, फर्ज निभाते निभाते, उसकी नजर से ही ना गिर जाए, मकबूलियत पाते पाते. Wow. Oh God, help me brave out temptations towards populistic decision making. Good morning all. I am Dr. Sanjay here from Nagpur, extending you greetings on a warm and a pleasant morning of a Sunday. I thank Alto and conveners for considering me for such a wonderful topic, which is close to my heart, diabetic donor. And I'm also happy that Dr. Mrinal presented his case, and he concluded by saying that he would like to work on the donor before actually considering. So probably he has considered my point. Well, initially, as the case was presented, I thought it is about a deceased donor kidney transplantation. But well, no, I found it was a live donor, and a live donor to me is never a patient. So the next question that comes to my mind is, will I turn her into one? Sorry to say, most likely, yes. Will I get away with it? Yes, most probably, again, unchallenged probably, because we belong to a country where all of us believe that in the long term, all of us will be dead. So should I go ahead? No, most certainly not, because my conscience still is alive. Now, when we look at the rear view mirror, what does it say? It says that the first kidney transplant was extremely cautiously performed between two identical twins in 1954. As time progressed, we started expanding the criteria and started including first degree relatives, then between compatible blood groups, and then now across ABO and compatible blood groups. So all these innovations we see were aimed at increasing the donor pool. So what is glaringly evident in this history is that donors were healthy and always unharmed. Compromise or improvisations were on the recipient side. Why? This was so because the ethical code, that is primum non nocere, was strictly adhered to. While transgressing this code, we have to be careful not to convert the scalpel into a knife. Meat of the question, or the mute question, is absence of renal disease isn't sufficient to authorize donation. We have no major Indian data to guide us through all these complex situations. The KDIGO guidelines state that donors with diabetes should be clearly told that their condition may progress to end organ complications over a period of time. And those with diabetes need to know the limitations of the current level of evidence and literature. So it just guides us to save our skin, not to save the donor. When I look at the bookshelf, which was very elaborately presented by Mrinal, I agree with him that expanded criteria transplant offers survival benefit over hemodialysis, but unfortunately, that is for deceased donors. Now, this large series, which comprised of 1,25,000 donors, it was followed up for 25 years, and it clearly states that diabetes was the leading cause of post-donation ESRD. In our case, the British Transplant Society guidelines, they say regarding BMI that otherwise healthy, overweight patients may safely proceed to donation. Our patient falls in this overweight category according to their guidelines. Post-donation weight gain is a significant observation, particularly in those who are overweight before donation. And at 10 years post-nephrectomy for BMI more than 30, 60% patients develop proteinuria and 30% develop CKD. Brass tacks of our particular case is that BMI is 27.5, which falls into overweight category. She has diabetes since 5 years, and 30% of diabetics will develop kidney disease, and 25% of ESRD are diabetics. So history of both diabetes and CKD in the family, these three factors actually make her a totally unfit candidate. She is herself in need of treatment. So more wiser options are deceased donor kidney transplant, wait list, or an altruistic donor. Both will be totally ethical, harmlessly therapeutic, and cogent options without any risk of jeopardizing the future of a normal individual. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay. Dr. Mrinal, quick rebuttal after Sanjay has put forth his point very nicely. Dr. Mrinal, quick rebuttal, save us some time. Mrinal, unmute yourself and proceed with your quick rebuttal. Good morning, Professor Anish.
Good morning, Ajay. Very nice program going on. Yes.
Mrinal, yes.
Yes, sir. So, am I audible?
Please.
Mic on. Yeah. So, I'll be presenting my rebuttal. I kind of agree and kind of disagree with Dr. Sanjay. But I would like to present the same points that he presented in his presentation. Firstly, I would like to begin with this. It was a study published in high-risk group of Blacks, African-Americans, where they asked the question whether a family history of ESKD can affect outcomes in live kidney donors. And they found out that family history is not associated with post-donation kidney function among African-American donors, and live kidney donation associated with although an increased risk of hypertension, which was independent of donor family history of ESKD. So, I was looking into the literature whether female gender played a protective role in ESRD, and I could come up with some studies in Finland, US, Japan, where they said that the percentage of women with ESRD was much less as compared to men. Another group of studies where they found that a male sex was more of a risk factor as compared to females when considering diabetic kidney disease. Again, I would like to reiterate the point that not all patients progress to diabetic nephropathy, especially a 55-year-old female would take at least about 30 years, even if she turns up into ESRD. As her present status, there is no major organ damage and normal albumin secretion as of now. So the same point was reiterated in this UK PDS study, where they said the median time taken would be anything in the range of 25 to 30 years from normal albuminuria to progressing to nephropathy. Again, would like to mention the same slide that sir mentioned, and it categorically says that decision to approve donor candidates with pre-diabetes or type 2 diabetes should be individualized based on demographic and health profile. And whereas it had excluded the type 1 patients with type 1 diabetes not to donate, but type 2 donors were still accessible. The working group considered that older candidates with type 2 diabetes with well-controlled glycemia, not requiring insulin and without end organ damage might be considered for donation. Same goes with the British Transplant Society. The again, some mentioned about this, and this is the statement that they make for diabetic donors, that in the absence of evidence of target organ damage and having ensured other cardiovascular risk factors have been taken care of, diabetes can be considered for kidney donation, having known their risk about it.
Renal
recent survey, just two more stats. So the recent survey suggests that the marginal donors, all these donors are being taken into consideration in US when it comes to live donors. And the reality is that regarding impaired fasting glucose, about half of the centers have no objection, which is again in contrast with the guidelines. This was an online survey study which showed that around 42 and 41% of renal transplant surgeons and nephrologists were okay with considering diabetic donors in their transplant program. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrunal. Sanjay, your rebuttal quickly, please. Save us some time.
Am I visible?
Please.
Yeah. I'm so happy to hear from Mrunal. I see my younger colleague are really struggling hard to persuade, to actually defend the indefensible. So as a I think I would like to more of, instead of a rebuttal, try to persuade him into believing his own point, which he has contradicted so many times. He has referred to the Western guidelines very often. Probably there is a handicap that Indian data is not there, but it is not totally absent. We do have an Indian data also. So the 2017 KDIGO framework does not represent population across all continents. It is mainly calibrated considering the US population. Indians differ and tend to have higher abdominal fat, liver, pancreatic fat, thereby higher risk of dyslipidemias and cardiovascular diseases, and lower lean mass compared to the Western population, along with increased insulin resistance and dysmetabolic state than the whites. Now, evaluation of living donors cannot be restricted to only detect CKD, and absence of CKD is certainly not sufficient to authorize donation. Normality at the time of donation does not necessarily predict the health status after donation. There is nothing normal in our patient, in our donor. A new calibration of calculators with a similar methodology on different cohorts, as suggested by KDIGO group 13, would be required in each geographical area. So it has to be, and even he has mentioned in his concluding statement that British Transplant Society also mentions if there is an obesity, the risk increases. Now, the Indian data or even the WHO, it has a different definition of BMI for Asia Pacific region, wherein it defines BMI of more than 25 kilogram per meter square as obesity instead of the 30, which is for the Western populations. Our patient is not overweight, she is already obese. Now in India, diabetes accounts for 40 to 60% of cases of CKD, and diabetes mellitus is the single most important risk factor for the development of CKD. So obesity continues contributes to the pathogenesis of kidney damage via development of diabetes and hypertension, and obese individuals are nearly 5 times more prone to develop CKD. Thus, the criteria of BMI more than 30 in the Western literature applies to our BMI more than 25. What it says is 60% of patients will develop proteinuria and 30% will develop renal insufficiency.
Sanjay, please hurry up.
Yeah, we are looking at a donor who has diabetes since 5 years, well-entrenched obesity, and a strong family history of diabetes and CKD. What more do we need to predict doom? So I would not be tempted by the delicious choice of making this donor a sacrifice of my benevolence. Instead, I will opt for DDKT and hope that rings a bell loud enough and serves as a course corrector for my colleague, and he chooses the scalpel over the knife. Thank you.
Thank you for your very nice rebuttal. I have one question to each of the debaters. Dr. Mrunal, please unmute yourself.
Yes, sir.
Had this donor also had hypertension, what would have been your decision?
Frankly speaking, sir, of course, no. Any other comorbidity, any other aberration in the donor's profile, and I would have said a strict no, sir.
Okay. Sanjay, there are few guidelines which state that these donors can be accepted under exceptional circumstances. Is this donor coming under exceptional circumstances?
Yes, sir.
The only exception is when you have no other option, as Mrinal said, he considers only the family, where we have options outside the family also. Fortunately, in India, with the population that is increasing and the awareness that is increasing, the deceased donor kidney transplantation list is moving very fast. And in the looking at her own status, she is already BMI very high, diabetes since 5 years, a very high age. You can say 53 is quite high age in our case also. And family history of CKD as well as diabetes mellitus. There are so many factors. What more do we need actually to act? Awaken to this possibility.
This is not that exceptional situation, correct?
It's not an exceptional situation.
Okay, right. Professor Anish, most welcome. Please let us know about your opinion of taking a diabetic donor.
Thank you, Ajay and Ultu, for giving this opportunity. So actually, I would go with Sanjay and I would not accept this donor. And reasons he has, I think, given enough.
Well, very well elaborated, yeah. Sir.
Yes.
Okay. Professor Georgie, what is your opinion about taking a diabetic donor? You have a vast experience of transplant.
I will not accept for donation from a diabetic patient, for live donation. Okay, from right. A deceased donor, okay, we can't accept it.
Dr. Sabnis, diabetes often is accompanied by obesity, hypertension, sometimes calculi. So there are multiple margins to be breached in a given donor. So when we are faced with multiple margins, not only diabetic, what is your decision in such situation? Multiple margins.
If you have multiple problems, obviously donor is completely rejected. There is no doubt about it. But in a given case like this, where you have the diabetes, which is there only for 2 years, and there is a family history of CKD, the donor's age is 55, there is no end organ damage. And we had a lot of discussion about it extensively with our nephrologist. And our policy now, with strict criteria, as Dr. Mrinal has mentioned, we accept such donor and we have large follow-up. Most of the times, these patients do quite well. But the only caveat is that these patients have to come under follow-up. And we spent actually time to convince that this patient needs a proper follow-up. Because there are instances where they are lost for follow-up and these patients then landed up in problem. So I accept with what Dr. Mrinal has said, we accept such donor with a strict caveat that there is no other comorbidities like obesity and other things, hypertension, etc. And they are willing to come for follow-up. Their background is such that they understand the thing and they come for follow-up. Then we accept such
donor. Okay, right, sir. Dr. Firoz, does number of anti-diabetic drugs and duration of diabetes has any influence on your decision about taking a diabetic donor?
Hey, I don't think the number of diabetes drugs has a decision. Certainly the duration of diabetes does have a play. If you have a long-standing diabetic donor, I would be a little reluctant to take her. But I agree with Sabnis. Since many, many years now in our program, we have been accepting diabetes donors. In an ideal world, we would never take a diabetic donor, but we don't live in an ideal world. We live in a world where our donor pool is very severely restricted. And all data now says if you have a well-controlled diabetic, glycosylated hemoglobins are normal, non-hypertensive, no albuminuria, no end organ or damage. If you take such a patient as a donor, chances of the donor ever reaching a stage of having future nephropathy is very, very, very low over the next 10 to 15 years. So right. In carefully selected cases, it's fine to go ahead. We've been doing that for many years. And I must say, we never really regretted it.
Does the relation between donor and recipient, the recipient who has secreted, does it matter? Say, these are siblings. Mother is diabetic and both of them are diabetic. Yes, doesn't matter.
Because, when you take a diabetic, you have issues in the donor, which as I've said are small, and you have risks in the recipient. The worst possible transplant outcome will come when you take a diabetic kidney and put it in a diabetic recipient. Every data shows that.
Right. Okay. So thank you very much for enlightening us. The jury on diabetes is still out. That is what I would say. Dr. Ranjan, your turn next. Present your case, present your debate, followed by your co-debater, Dr. Dhanpal. Please proceed, Ranjan. Ranjan, save me some minutes, please.
Yes, sir, I'm trying to. So, am I able to share my screen, sir?
Please share.
Are you seeing the screen?
No, not yet.
I cannot see, sir.
Now?
No. No. Ranjan, now your screen is
okay. So it's the presentation is visible, sir.
Yes, yes, please proceed, Ranjan.
So good morning, everyone, and today I'm going to present a case in which we had a donor who had a renal mass of around, say, 3.7 centimeters, close to 4 centimeters. So we were contemplating whether to accept this as a donor or not. So this index patient is a 39 years old male, poorly tolerating dialysis, multiple ICU admissions, and the only suitable donor was his wife, who was 38 years old. She was having a left renal mass 3.9 centimeters into 4 centimeters. The GFR was 81, 40 and 41. The 24 hours urine proteinuria was 246 milligrams in 24 hours. So this is the CT scan of the donor, and you can see the mass appearing here. So this is the mass. So in all the three views, you can have a idea of the mass, which is close to 4 centimeters, and it is partly endophytic also. So I would be speaking towards accepting this donor. So the first important point I would like to put is, why waste a nephron mass? This is a tumor, and why should we venture into it? We all know that organ shortage is there. There's a huge waiting list, and dialysis has a very, very poor survival. Usually CRF patients have significant comorbidities, which precludes long waiting times, and it leads to certain death within a couple of years. The important point is, now the non-urologists are lesser in number versus the urologists who are doing transplants, especially in the kidney. There's excellent experience of partial nephrectomy with just these small renal masses. Excision have already been established in donation after brain death. What does the literature say? The literature now is almost getting clear that it is safe and feasible. There is very low recurrence rate, even in RCC. There's hardly any DGF, not very significant blood loss. Urine leak is rare and mostly manageable. There are four risks, which are four potential risks, which one should consider. That is the tumor recurrence, torrential bleeding, the time, ischemia time, which get increased because of reconstruction of these kidneys, and technical issues in PCS reconstruction, which might result in urine leak. So I found so many studies, more than say 17, 18 papers regarding small kidney masses. There have been multiple studies, but I would like to attract the attention of the audience to this paper, which is a review article and very recently published in 2018, which has clearly established the effectiveness of using a small renal mass in transplant. So authors have analyzed approximately 18 papers, total of say 108 patients, and they have assessed the oncological outcomes as well as the non-oncological outcomes. So the conclusions of this paper, this large review, were that there were 17 studies, 107 patients, and the follow-up was reasonably large. So long-term follow-up is there up to 11 years, more than 93% patients, and graft survival at 1-3 at 5 years. There's no difference in different immunosuppression regimes. Small renal masses should not prohibit kidney donation. Recurrence is very rare, 100% recurrence-free survival at 5 years. Almost whatever recurrences occurred, they occurred only after 5 years. So we have given a good life of 5 years to the patient. And almost all the recurrences could be managed. Only one patient had a metastasis, that too was managed by allograft nephrectomy. So using such kidneys provides both quality and quantity of life. Usual cutoff in most of the studies is 2.3 centimeters for safety, but many authors have accepted up to 5 centimeters as well. And the oncological as well as non-oncological outcomes in terms of delayed graft function, leak, acute rejection are all acceptable. So any team who has a good experience of partial nephrectomy and a good experience of transplant surgery and experienced anesthesiologist who can handle a blood loss as an endourological armamentarium should go ahead with such kind of transplants. Thank you, sir.
Yes, Dr. Dhanpal.
Yes,
sir. Very nice presentation. Dr. Dhanpal, tell us why would you not accept this donor? Ranjan, stop sharing, please.
Yeah, I've done that, sir.
Dhanpal, already thank you.
No. Just trying to get my presentation. To thank the organizers for having made this program a reality. I like the legend behind that, Urology Learning Through Others' Experience. It's a nice title. And thank you for giving me a chance to be a part of this program. Next slide. In all the urology that we have practiced, the transplant, the uro-oncology, every time we talk of this moments in time. 30 years ago, I would have rejected any donor more than 60 years. Definitely no hypertension. But these are being considered as a reality today. We do consider all these. The same is true for small renal masses. It would have been easier to discuss 25 years back. It would have been yes or no. A resoundingly no from my side. But because of the acute shortage of organs, it is a given fact that we have to accept such donors. So my arguments will be a relative no instead of an absolute no. There are some caveats which have to be followed. If these are not followed, definitely it is a relative no. So expectedly, I saw the presentation. I expect the following, that this is the only available donor. It's a T1A lesion. The needle biopsy indicates a low malignant potential, preferably a clear cell carcinoma. I'm very worried of a papillary cells here as they tend to be multicentric. I expect tuberous sclerosis for Imbal-Landau syndrome to have been ruled out. SRM is only in this kidney and not on the contralateral side. I expect it to be a polar mass or on the convex border. I would have definitely not liked to be an endophytic lesion. Now, all this follows because we have been accepting nephron sparing surgery in uro-oncology as a method of treatment for as alternative to radical nephrectomy. So in this case, a donor will have has to be intense, including HRCT of the chest and preferably MRI of the abdomen. It cannot be a person's individual opinion. It has to be a team's opinion. And the team here in this case becomes bigger. The nephrologist should also accept the fact that he has to change the immunosuppression. There's no place for CNI or anti-proliferative agents. Preferably to use mTOR inhibitors. The transplant surgeon, as was mentioned, just a transplant who does not have onco experience, then it is wise to include a uro-oncologist during the active surgery. I would prefer a high-quality medical counselor, especially a urological colleague who is not a part of the transplant team, to have a detailed counseling of the patient and the relatives, because there are accepted complications like bleeding, urine leak, relative ischemia at the cut margin, AV aneurysm, AV fistula, increased ischemia time. And in such cases, partial nephrectomy, it has to be a proper 5 millimeter margin and not 2 millimeter as is accepted in a nephron sparing surgery. The lymphocele occurrence, all these are factors which has to be educated to the recipient also, and hence also the chance of metachronous donors in the transplanted kidney. Recurrence in the transplant, all these are to be anticipated by the recipient. And after all this, if he accepts, then possibly I may say a relative yes. There also has to be realized that small kidney masses taking from an older donor, like a 60-year-old, then you have a young recipient, 20-year-old or 25-year-old recipient, accepting a renal mass. So you have to take into consideration the biological life of the kidney, not the donor alone. So this also has to be informed. And you need a very good high-power ethics committee which has been well informed. So I would like to give it as a guidelines for kidney donors. So you have to have guidelines for ethics committee, guidelines for high quality counseling, preferably a good urologic colleague who's not a part of the team, because as in general, it's not wise for the active participant to go and counsel the recipient. Guidelines for preoperative workup, intense donor workup and recipient workup. Then guidelines for managing BTC, that is donor transplanted cancer. There is high chances of donor transplanting the cancer, high chances of donor and the donor originated cancer. Proper guidelines for proper consent. If you want to go to the right child column, you have for cadaveric donors. In general, we don't do imaging of a cadaveric donor. We are accepting that on table, whatever is the finding from the harvested organs, we accept that. But there could be a good possibility that there could be a malignancy in the donor which is not apparent. As in France, they definitely consider cadaveric donor radial imaging.
Then, please hurry up, please.
Proper guidelines of fine millimeter margin, then guidelines for proper harvesting of the donor. Is there a role for lymph clearance? And as I said, biological kidney, a biological age of the kidney. And obviously, you have to consider guidelines for investigating the near relatives, both the donor and the recipient. So guidelines, again, for proper medical-legal outcomes, guidelines for permanent data storing, because these are oncological outcomes, not necessarily only transplant outcomes. So you have to think of 5-year, 10-year, 15-year survival of the kidney.
Dr. Dhanpal, please proceed faster.
If you don't do any good, at least do no harm. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Dhanpal, for your presentation. Dr. Ranjan, please quickly present your rebuttal.
All right, sir. Is my screen visible, sir?
Yes, sir.
So, thank you, sir. Dhanpal, sir, as I fully agree with Dhanpal, sir, whatever points he has made are very, very important. Since we are speaking to a larger audience and who are going to follow some kind of advice from us. So whatever points he has made, I fully agree with him that the person should have reasonable experience, the team should be involved, and each word, whatever he has said. In my belief, whatever resistance is there amongst our urologist transplant surgeon community, there are some constant threats. Number one is a nephrologist who is always there and asking a lot of questions. So our programs are mostly nephrology oriented programs, nephrology dominated, nephrology based programs. And as a surgeon, we don't want to take responsibility for anything, any adverse outcome. And then there is a financial burden on the patients. That is why we, as surgeons, are afraid of it. Suppose the patient has DGF, suppose the patient has bleeding. So it is going to increase the hospital stay, it is going to increase a lot of financial implications. So that is why we are afraid. Surgeons usually, they don't want to land up into controversies. They want a clean cut patient from the nephrologist, do a transplant and forget it. And in the era of COPRA, it becomes more significant. So remember, a transplant is a life saving surgery. It's not even a surgery for a transplant surgeon at heart. It's a journey for the patient. The patient may be the only insurance owner. In India, we don't have government taking care of any patient or something. He may be the only breadwinner. So we have to look into the family, talk to the family, speak to the family. Guidelines will keep on evolving. We have to judicially select our recipient. And we have to explain to the family, rather than talking to the nephrologist, we should sit with the family to discuss the harms of receiving this kidney vis-a-vis the harms of not getting this kidney, because not getting this kidney means a certain death for the patient. And the other points which Dr. Dhanpal sir had made, that he has clearly said that it is a relative no, it's not an absolute no. And a few points for Dr. Dhanpal's presentation, that there is no need of change in immunosuppression. In the recent paper which I've showed you of 2018, which has clearly showed that there is no difference in oncological outcomes based on the regimes of immunosuppression. And there is not a very significant high chance of transplanting cancer into the recipient. The, around 17-18 studies which have been published show a very, very low recurrence rate of any malignancy. So we have to talk to the family, keep the science evolving. We have to take the nephrologist into confidence, convince him, arrange a good blood bank, leukoreduced BRCs are there so that the chances of rejection.
Anjan, please hurry up.
Okay, so the, just ending up with this video.
People talk glibly about science. What is science? People coming out of a university with a master's degree or a PhD, you take them into the field and they literally don't believe anything, and this is a peer-reviewed paper. It's the only thing they accept. And you say to them, but let's observe, let's think, let's discuss. They don't do it. It's just, is it in a paper, peer-reviewed paper or not? That's their view of science. I think it's pathetic. Gone into universities as bright young people, they come out of them brain dead, not even knowing what science means. They think it means peer-reviewed papers, etc. No, that's academia. And if a paper is peer-reviewed, it means everybody thought the same, therefore they approved it. An unintended consequence is that when new knowledge emerges, new scientific insights, they can never, ever be peer-reviewed. So we're blocking all new advances in science that are big advances. If you look at the breakthroughs in science, almost always they don't come from the center of that profession. They come from the fringe.
And then I would have to request you to stop.
The world couldn't even think of electric lights. They don't come from within there.
Dr. Dhanpal, please. Quick rebuttal.
It's not embracing as a slide, but all these SRMs, small renal masses, there is no randomized trial anywhere. There are large reviewed slide abstracts and meta-analysis, but there is no randomized controlled trial anywhere in the world. The largest series is 140 cases. These are all collated data from one institution or multiple institutions, but no randomized trial, whether in cadaveric or in Lyme related. So I cannot agree with Dr. Priyadarshi that we have to, yes, we have to agree, we have to accept these kind of donors. But unfortunately, there is no, as in that last film that we showed, there is no peer-reviewed chance of a peer-reviewed paper because there has been no randomized trial. These are all collated data of a few centers doing a few extra cases. I have done 5 cases, somebody has done 20 cases, or some institution that have done 30 cases. And it is the data of this. And the largest oncological follow-up has been just 9 years, in which there was one patient who has had a recurrence in the tumor at the pole at the nephrectomized site, partial nephrectomized site. So I, for one, we are still evolving. The last, the jury is still out there. I cannot say that this has to be accepted by one and all. That's why it was my argument that we will not like to take this with the just shouting down my throat. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Dhanpal. Now, Ranjan, please tell us, is FNSE always necessary before accepting such a donor?
No, sir, not at this point of time. And especially when we are not equipped with the biomarkers. So in Western countries, there is a trend towards doing an FNSE and maybe an FNAP, but these labs are equipped with biomarkers. They tell you the exact classification of RCC, whether it is clear cell versus non-clear cell. They can actually grade and stage the disease. So these facilities are still not available in our country. So at this point of time, in our present scenario, we don't have to go in for an FNAC.
Okay. Do you do frozen section of the base of the tumor before transplanting these kidneys?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And how far do you go to do a metastatic workup of these donors?
So we usually do a PET CT scan, whole body PET CT.
Okay, right. Dr. Dhanpal,
yes,
when you select these kind of donors, do you have any limitation vis-a-vis the histopathology of the tumor, that this histopathology of this small renal mass, I would not take this donor? Is there any limitation in your opinion?
In my opinion, I prefer a renal cell clear cell carcinoma, preferably a low-grade disease. And I am for one, I firmly believe whether it is urological, whether it's a renal cell CA or whether it's a CA penis, I always prefer, even if I'm doing a nephron sparing surgery for a partial nephrectomy in an oncology case, I always prefer doing a lymph node clearance. So I do get extra information from the lymph nodes, because I had one case where we did a partial nephrectomy from one.
Dr. Dhanpal.
As far as this case is concerned, I would not prefer a papillary cell CA.
Okay, Dr. Dhanpal, we'll not venture into the discussion of lymph node dissection at present in this scenario. Is there any age consideration for recipient when you accept donor with small renal mass, or and does immunosuppression has a bearing on recurrence? These two questions.
There are a few reports as far as the second part of the question. Calcineurin inhibitors are supposedly known to increase the chances of lymphomas. It has not been proved for renal cell CA, neither it has been proved for papillary cell CA, and definitely not azathioprine. But other mTOR inhibitors can easily be considered. Now, what is the first part of the question, sir?
Consideration of age of donor and recipient while selecting such a donor.
I mentioned that in partly that if you're taking a SRM, a 60-year-old from a 60-year-old person, you have to always take into consideration the biological age of the kidney. So if I'm going to transplant it to a 20-year-old person, I'll be very worried. Since there have been no guidelines to now, it will be my personal opinion at that particular time. Maybe I will be very comfortable it was the other way around. If I was a 20-year-old fellow with SRM.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dhanpal. So
yes,
we now move to question and answer with the experts. Dr. Sabnis.
Yes.
Should nephrometry score be done in all these donors?
No, there is no question of nephrometry score. Basically, we have to ask the question ourselves whether in a live situation, whether you will accept such donor or not. The CT scan which was shown, now small renal mass, there is a limit. What is small? 2 centimeter also is small and 4 centimeter also is small. But there is a gross difference. If you see the histology, if it is a malignancy, then definitely there is no question of taking this patient as a donor, simply because it is a risk to the donor. We know that the histology of papillary has the multicentric, even other kidneys at risk. So in future, if she gets a tumor in the other kidney, it's a solitary kidney, there are 7% chance that this patient, in a 38 years old male, can develop metastasis. And that time the GFR will be single kidney GFR, all the TK and various other things which you want to do it, it is not going to be appropriate. And therefore, very, very small renal incidentally detected mass, 40% chance that it is to be benign. Those patients can be accepted. The way you have shown this CT scan, there is an endophytic component, there's an exophytic component, significant 4 centimeter mass. I would definitely reject this donor as a donor, because there is a threat to the donor. And of course, we know the problems in the recipient also. Technically, yes, on the bench, you can remove it. There is no problem. You can do thorough job, but it's a risk to the donor.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sabnis, for mentioning these points crystal clear. Thank you very much. Professor Anish, share your wisdom on taking a donor with a small renal mass.
Yeah. So I think I agree with Ravindra. And because the small renal mass, as he has already clarified, that, you know, they all do not fall into the same basket or same category. Talking about this particular patient, I think he should get a benefit of partial nephrectomy, which is universal. And therefore, I would not like to take him as a donor.
Right. Thank you very much, sir. Professor Georgi Abraham, have you, in your experience, taken these donors and then repented after doing the transplant?
We never allowed to take a donor with the renal mass. So totally, we will not accept renal mass patient for donation.
Okay. Dr. Firoz, what is your opinion about taking small renal masses, query malignancy, as donors?
Yeah, I would accept such a donor only if my back was absolutely pushed to the wall. As a routine, we would never accept. As Ravi has said, one is you are converting what should be a partial nephrectomy into a total nephrectomy for the donor. Second, the risks to the recipient are totally unknown. He has mentioned those studies. They are all that study of 147 cases, second study of 107 cases. They are all a collation of worldwide studies. There is only one study from one center which goes up to 38 cases coming out of Australia. The rest of the studies which make up that 147 patients are all single case, two cases, three cases. So they are not really, we don't really have any studies or data on what will happen to the recipient long term. So as I said, I would do it only if I was pushed to the wall. I had a recipient who was not doing well on dialysis, whose expected survival without dialysis or without a transplant would not be more than a few years. And with an understanding donor, then with due consideration, we might accept it. But as a routine, no one.
If you accept these donors, would there be a strong role of nephrometry and assessing whether you are giving the recipient a good enough nephron mass?
I'm not sure if that is relevant, because here you have a situation where presumably the recipient has no other possible donor, is not doing well on dialysis, and is desperate for a kidney without which he is not likely to survive long. So you're accepting that donor in the first case. You know, okay, you are going to get a suboptimal kidney because a large part of the nephron mass is already going to be removed. I would not reject the donor totally based on that nephrometry score. I'm not sure how important that would be.
Okay, and nephrometry score basically is to see whether the partial nephrectomy is easy or not. Okay. So the question of assessing with nephrometry score here is going to be relevant. If you are going to take, you are going to remove it on the bench. Bench taking out this tumor is not a big thing at all. So technically there is no problem. So nephrometry score per se may not have any relevance in this case.
Okay. The question coming from audience is, should you give consideration to the remaining nephron mass which you are transplanting into the recipient?
No, remaining nephron mass has to be under surveillance, and everything actually will depend on what is the histology. If at all you transplant such kidney, if it is a papillary tumor, if it is a clear cell carcinoma with the Perman gate 3 and gate 4, we have seen small renal masses having this histology. There are sometimes you get even in a 3 cm mass a variant histology. These are aggressive tumors. So with the addition of immunosuppression, with such type of histology, you are in a major problem. That recipient has to be not only from the transplant follow-up, but has to be under strict oncological follow-up for the remaining kidney.
Thank you very much, sir. We now proceed to the next case, that is incidentally detected right renal artery stenosis in a donor. So here is a case of 62 years father who is being evaluated as a donor for his son who is due for a second KT, and the cause of CKD is IgA nephropathy. He has good enough GFR, but and all other donor parameters are absolutely normal. He is non-hypertensive, non-diabetic, no albuminuria, and USG is normal. The catch came in form of this CT angio, which shows a 90% stenosis in right renal artery, 1 cm distal to the ostium of right renal artery. That's the renal artery stenosis. These are the CT scan pictures. And I request Dr. Mukund to present his side of the debate. He has chosen not to take this donor. I'll end my slideshow here and request Dr. Mukund to present his side of the debate. Dr. Mukund.
Yes, Sajid. Thank you so much.
You have chosen not to take this donor.
Yeah. Thank you very much for allowing me here today to participate in this debate. All right, am I audible? Am I visible?
Please, please.
Right. First, to no harm, said Hippocrates. Let's evaluate this donor, keeping this in mind. He's a living kidney donor, elderly male, and with 90% renal artery stenosis. Old is not always gold, especially in surgical field. There are many issues with advancing age, and it's not just a number. Beyond 50, there is progressive loss of nephron mass. There are greater risks of perioperative complications. KDIGO guidelines clearly mention that donation may accelerate a rise in blood pressure and need for antihypertensive treatments over and above expectations with normal aging. This paper highlights a very important point. Older donors have diminished filtration function at baseline, and this impairs their ability of the remnant kidney to perform adaptive hyperfiltration and hence promotes progressive kidney disease. British guidelines also say the similar things as highlighted by this particular paper, which says that there is relatively lower graft function in more than 60-year-old patients, increased rejection episodes, and poor long-term graft survival. So in effect, elderly donor has its own issues. Now you add to it the renal artery stenosis. Renal artery stenosis can be either because of atherosclerosis in 90% of the cases and FMD in 10% of the cases. This donor probably has renal artery stenosis due to atherosclerosis because of his old age and proximal lesion. However, even if we consider that this donor has FMD, the evidence is clearly against it. This article says that candidates with severe or moderate FMD detected in one kidney should not be accepted for donation because of the tendency of bilateral involvement and possible development of disease after many years in the remnant of the donated kidney. Even mild FMD in a normotensive potential donor cannot be considered as a benign condition. And this fact is highlighted by this particular case, which was published. In this patient, she had donated the left kidney, but the FMD recurred in the right side after 8 years. Another case study is reiterating the same point. Let's move our discussion to atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis. What happens in atherosclerosis? What is critical stenosis? This patient has 90% stenosis. In 70 to 80% stenosis, it's necessary to produce more than 40% reduction in RBF, that is renal blood flow, and this is termed as critical stenosis. With 80% stenosis, the perfusion pressure drops to 70 to 80. At this point, kidney cannot autoregulate its GFR and RBF. So, and as Campbell says, as the degree of stenosis increases up to 50%, the artery distal to stenosis has low pressures, and at this lower perfusion, the pathophysiologic process of ischemic nephropathy initiates. So my argument is this kidney donor has, with 90% stenosis, already has ischemic changes in place. You said renal artery stenosis without hypertension in this patient. Am I happy? No, not at all. Renal artery stenosis is a progressive disease that may result in gradual and silent loss of functional renal tissue. And mind you, in this study, there were half of the patients not hypertensive. You said renal artery stenosis is unilateral in this patient. Well, really, I think it has bilateral effects. Let's see this study, which was published in Nephrology in Journal, says that there is now overwhelming evidence that damage often also occurs within the contralateral kidney that is unaffected by renal artery stenosis. And therefore, we would anticipate that in patients with atheroma, changes of atherosclerotic nephropathy are likely to occur in kidneys, both affected and unaffected by significant RAS. So my argument is it is present in both the kidneys. Well, CT angiography in this donor says rest of the vasculature is normal, and that is why you conclude that left is normal. But is it real so? Can CT angiography see everything? this article in Journal of Radiology says that CT angiography has nearly 93% sensitivity in diagnosing severe 50% stenosis of the renal artery, while only 54, it drops to 54 to 60% sensitivity in diagnosis of mild stenosis, less than 50%. So even if we say that there are normal results from CT angiography, it cannot rule out renal artery stenosis. If you really have to diagnose these, then they advocate performing DSA, which we don't do in most of the cases or in all our cases. So my argument is RAS, renal artery stenosis, is a potentially bilateral disease, and KDIGO guidelines clearly say that donors with a bilateral RAS should be rejected. Let's move on to transplant renal artery stenosis. TRAS it's called. Can atherosclerosis in donor be the culprit? Well, if you go on to Peter Morris, there's a large series they have quoted which say donor artery atherosclerosis is present in 27% of the cases as a factor. The same factor is reiterated by EAU guidelines, which also quote small caliber of the donor artery and atherosclerosis of the donor artery to be a cause or to be of the factor in renal artery stenosis. Also the same point in one of the articles here. This article I have brought in with making another point of view, that difference in the donor more than 15 years, donor and the recipient, is significantly linked to the risk of developing arteriosclerosis after renal transplantation. So all the factors in this patient are against. Therefore, I conclude that I would reject this elderly marginal donor with 90% renal artery stenosis. Thank you, Ore.
Thank you, Mukund. I request Dr. Amit to proceed with his arguments for accepting this donor. Dr. Amit.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Alto and Dr. Oswal, for giving this opportunity. So, I am defending why I am taking this kidney donor with renal artery stenosis. The facts I would like to highlight here, that the common reason for the renal artery stenosis is atherosclerosis and the fibromuscular dysplasia. This gentleman is 62-year-old male with no history of hypertension, no proteinuria, kidney size is normal, differential renal function is normal. However, we have not done the captopril scintigraphy. So he is more than 45 year old age, which suggests that it is atherosclerosis. But at the same time, it is involving little middle part of the renal artery, no calcification at the orifice. So probably we are not sure that we are dealing with fibromuscular dysplasia with late presentation in male, or really it is atherosclerosis as suggested by my colleague, Dr. Mukund. So why I am trying to accept this donor? Because there is need for accepting marginal donor.
Amit, your presentation donor is well established. Amit, your presentation is not seen.
Sorry. I have already shared.
No, we are not seeing it.
Is it seen now?
Yes. Make it full screen.
Yeah. So, just I had told that these were the point with the donor, and I was thinking that it is fibromuscular dysplasia or atherosclerosis. So now I am trying to accept this donor because there is issue of marginal donor. We need to accept these donors. Safety of donor with renal artery stenosis is well established. And long-term allograft outcome of such donor is also very satisfactory. And I would like to prove this thing with review literature. So everybody knows that there is a serious organ shortage, and most of the studies are now accepted these patients, this donor with the renal vascular disease, to expand the donor pool. And if you keep the patient not accepting such donor and keep this donor for the eligible cadaveric transplantation, it not increases the mortality risk, but also increases the financial burden to the recipient. And that is the reason that across the globe, donor with unilateral renal artery stenosis is well acceptable. Now we see the donor safety. The primary concern here is the hypertension in the donor. At present, this donor is not having hypertension, but yes, future risk of hypertension is there, and recurrence of such lesion in the solitary kidney, because sometimes fibromuscular dysplasia is 30 to 60% of time may be bilateral. So there are many literature, like in this, they have done two cases report where the patient donor was hypertensive along with the renal artery stenosis. And this donor kidney was not only the functioning in the recipient, but also donor became normotensive. So sometimes hypertension because of the renal artery stenosis is also being cured after the donation. And because there is no hypertension, so risk of apposite kidney will be less. If you see the long-term outcome of this donor in fibromuscular dysplasia, like this study, where almost 9,000 kidney donors were evaluated in a span of 50 years, out of that, 113 donors were with fibromuscular dysplasia. And these group of patients, fibromuscular dysplasia patients were little older. It is not always there that young patients are also always having fibromuscular dysplasia. However, this is more common in women and the systolic blood pressure is little high. So what they saw that in the follow-up of almost 15 to 25 years, the hypertension risk, proteinuria risk and cardiovascular risk is comparable. And no donor with FMD developed GFR less than 30 ml per minute per meter square, and multivariate analysis risk for the mortality, cardiovascular disease and renal outcome was not elevated. So carefully selected candidates with such type of renal stenosis can safely donate. Now we see the recipient outcome, what happens if we take such type of kidney. So good article where 36 donors, out of that 26 donors were having unilateral disease and 10 were having bilateral disease. And overall outcome was 89%. None of the patients was having rejection because of vascular disease. And the median serum creatinine, however, is little higher, 1.6 milligram percent. And most of the patient were having either no need of antihypertensive or even if there is a need, two or more antihypertensive was suffice to take care of the hypertension. So selected patient with such renal artery stenosis can be accepted as renal donor, and they increase the donor pool and waiting time for the transplantation. Now, this is a very landmark study which shows that sometimes we prejudice that there is a significant arterial stenosis. So there may be impact on the renal kidney and this kidney may not be acceptable. So this study highlights with the aim that whether kidney with macroscopic arteriosclerosis of the renal artery should be discarded or not only because of that, or there is any correlation of this arteriosclerosis with the transplant outcome, or there is correlation with histological sign of parenchymal biopsy. So what they found that transplant clinicians are much more inclined to discard the aged diseased donor kidney where microscopic arteriosclerosis is there. And subjective, they believe that it could be a reason for primary non-functioning of the kidney, but there is no effect on delayed graft function, eGFR at 1 year, or long-term survival outcome of such disease. So only basis of the renal artery stenosis in angiogram, we should not decide. And they have found that kidney discard based on this very subjective renal artery assessment should always be discouraged. And the intragraft arterial sclerosis, which is based on parenchymal biopsy, usually improve the predictive capacity for renal transplant outcome. So this should be not a biased opinion for seeing the angiography that this kidney will work or this kidney will not work. Thank you.
Thank you both the debaters for putting your points forth very, very nicely. Dr. Mukund, your rebuttal, please, and make it quick. Mukund, your rebuttal, quick. Unmute yourself, Mukund. Mukund, unmute yourself. Mukund, unmute yourself.
Yes, I'm doing it. One second. All right. Let's see what happens to renal transplants with donors having renal vascular disease. There is literally a paucity of literature on long-term follow-ups in both. Amit quoted that article, and it is some of the articles are just starting to pour in. But this article, one of the articles which I found, had 11 patients and they had 4 graft losses. Although they said it is, they cannot conclude why this happened, and it may not be because of atherosclerosis, but it needs more clarity. This article also, where they have taken renal vascular diseases, has said the first sentence that donors with renal artery stenosis is controversial due to potential for systemic and progressive disease in the donor. And donor safety is of paramount importance to us. So donors with atherosclerosis, narrowing of the renal artery, must be carefully selected and informed of this possibility. Now, if this donor donates the right kidney, you can compare it with the half-filled glass. It depends on how you look at it. The question is not if the glass is half empty or half full. It is, will that half glass last long enough to quench the thirst for the most demanding portion of this patient, of the race called life? In this elderly male, impaired ability of solitary remnant kidney to perform adaptive hyperfiltration to support the increased demand in the rest of his life. Renal artery stenosis, atherosclerosis, FMD, all potentially bilateral or a systemic disease. Inability of CT angio alone to detect early stenosis on opposite side. And paucity of literature on long-term effects in donor and recipient. I don't think it's a real life situation. In real life, all is not well. I would reject this donor.
Thank you, Mukund. Amit, your turn.
Thanks.
Amit, quick.
Yes, yeah. So my point, like Dr. Mukund told, that this is an elderly donor and it is not safe to take that kidney. But we have enough literature where the elderly living donors has given their kidney, and now we are slowly moving from 60 years to the 65 year of donor, because the risk of death and ESRD is similar. The functional loss is also not different. The result of transplantation is also equivalent, and it is reasonably safe for taking elderly donor, and age per se is certainly not a contraindication for the donation. He is also talking about the long-term outcome in the donor. And this is a study where we are seeing the long-term outcome. They have differentiated between the 19 patients who opted for the donor nephrectomy and 18 patients who were rejected for the donation, either because the other available better donor was available or the severity of disease, they didn't consent for the donor nephrectomy. And see what happened, that the 19 patients who underwent donor nephrectomy, at the follow-up of 45 years, no donor had hypertension, proteinuria, or any significant form of raise in serum creatinine than the baseline value. And 18 patients who not opted for the donor nephrectomy or not taken for the donor nephrectomy, 11 patients who could be followed, they also had no hypertension, proteinuria, or abnormal serum creatinine. That means that there is always some presumption that this should progress, but really this disease is not that progressive. So what they concluded, that decision to take this donor should be based on patient age. Yes, availability of other suitable donor. They should always be taken as a marginal donor, not as a primary donor. And also the extent and severity of disease should be better considered. Now we see what happens to the long-term outcome in the recipient. Amit, like this is the study where 11 patients, where did the long-term outcome out of 283 patients and the follow-up of more than 7.5 years. So what happened to this 11 graft? There was no post-operative complication. 4 recipients were extremely doing well. 3 patients who developed hypertension was also hypertensive before transplantation.
Amit,
one patient had hypertension after 10 years, but that was not because of FMD. No recipient with functioning graft evidence FMD progression at the late. All donors are well with normal renal function. To date, none of the donors are having FMD. So recipient is also safe and donor is also safe. Now, many centers where they have found that it is a very severe disease and it cannot be surgically very challenging, they have also done with use of venous grafting or the arterial graft, and they have found it is successful in the recipient and also safe in the donor. So take-home message from my side is that the use of kidney from aged living donor with mild unilateral renal artery stenosis is safe for both donor and recipient. But yes, this need careful donor evaluation and regular follow-up for both donor and recipient. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dr. Mukund, you were talking about role of DSA in such donors. If I tell you that we will do DSA, will you accept this donor? Or would you compulsorily do DSA in all such donors, Dr. Mukund?
TJ, my point is renal angiography, the CT renal angiography, which we do, the literature says, cannot diagnose opposite side renal artery stenosis. It is not as sensitive in diagnosing mild affection of the arteries as sensitive in more than 50% stenosis. That is the point I wanted to bring forward. If you are bound to take this donor, I would suggest if you don't want to do DSA because it's invasive, you should add one more investigation like MRI and Doppler just to be sure that opposite side is not missed. The smaller lesions on the opposite side are not missed. That's it.
Okay, got your point. Mukund, your limitation or not accepting donors with renal artery stenosis, do you make any difference between FMD and atherosclerosis, or any stenosis is a no-no for you?
FMD, Ajay, I mean, I have quoted few studies which clearly say is a bilateral disease, and there are examples that it has recurred in later ages. So even Amit presented few studies which they have taken. It's a marginal case. It's not 100% sure, but there are case studies published in the literature where FMD has recurred in the remnant kidney and they had to do an angioplasty. Now you have to accept this risk if you want to accept this donor.
Okay, right. Dr. Amit, do you make any difference while selecting a donor with renal artery stenosis? Say, would you accept any donor with renal artery stenosis of any cause, or atherosclerosis and FMD doesn't make any difference to you?
I think I will give much consideration to the age. If he is a younger age group patient with renal artery stenosis, I will be little more cautious in taking this donor. But yes, in elderly donor, because what I have seen with this literature come to know that this is a very slow growing disease. So if you are taking an elderly donor with renal artery stenosis, risk of getting recurrence of disease in his lifespan is very, very minimal.
No, but yes, my question is FMD versus atherosclerosis, would you draw a line? My question is
usually no, I will have no reservation. Either it is atherosclerosis or the FMD I would like to take if otherwise he is fit, but not as a first choice, only as a marginal donor.
Thank you very much. Now, Dr. Sabnis, I request you to tell us, suppose CT angiography has additional finding of a stenosis of 50% in either celiac trunk or superior mesenteric artery. Will that change your decision?
Yeah, so if this patient has the multiple arterial stenosis, obviously this case is not suitable for the, because he has got a generalized disease which is progressive and it can happen anywhere. But the case which you showed that there is a single stenosis, yes, 1 centimeter from the ostium, 62 years old male, you have combined CT scan with isotoporinogram, which is not showing any deterioration in function, no microalbuminuria, no left ventricular hypertrophy, retina is normal. In this case, I have no hesitation to accept this as a donor, because other kidney is normal, your GFR is normal, isotoporinogram is normal. And when you take this patient as the donor, in the recipient, you go to the proximal end, discard that segment, make a wide spatulated anastomosis, and even the recipient, no problem, distal runoff is quite good. The rest of the kidney on angiography is perfectly normal. So my take in this case is that it's an isolated single stenosis, which can be accepted. And quite often we have seen people talking of 50%, 60%, 30%, 80%. It is all arbitrary. You have to see everything in toto. What is if he has no hypertension, no microalbuminuria, no left ventricular hypertrophy, everything is fine, kidney size is normal, everything is normal, then you can't accept this as isolated as a 90% stenosis. It may appear as a stenosis segment, but functionally it does not fit into that. So there is no hesitation taking that as a donor.
had there been bilateral similar lesions in renal artery and all other arteries normal, what would you be?
If it is a multiple arteries involved, no,
bilateral renal artery stenosis, all other arteries
no,
normal.
No question of taking that as a donor. If it is a multiple artery, bilateral renal artery, in addition to that, if there are multiple other arteries, coronary, celiac, other things, there is no question of accepting as a donor.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sabnis. Professor Georgie Abraham, please enlighten us about technical tips of doing this laparoscopic right donor nephrectomy in this particular situation.
This 62-year-old father with a solitary isolated lesion at the middle of the right renal artery, remaining artery adequate length is available. And this case, we can proceed with the donor nephrectomy on the right side. Laparoscopically, our technique is that it is the after complete mobilization, it is the terminal hand assisted. For retrieval, we have to make a 6 centimeter the right loin, the Gibson incision, prove that our left hand is introduced and the kidney is in our hand. After, with the finger, we can support the vessels and we can do a safe clipping of the artery and divide it. This particular case, the division will come exactly at that stenotic segment. The vein is also by using the finger manipulation, we can use two hemlock clips, we can apply safely, and adequate length of vein also will be available. So we can safely proceed in this particular scenario also by laparoscopic right donor nephrectomy.
Thank you. Dr. Firoz, what precautions would you take while doing this recipient surgery after retrieving this kidney with a renal artery stenosis? Any special precautions while you do recipient surgery with this kidney?
I think in this patient, the only specific thing would be that you will expect a short renal artery, because ideally you would like to excise that narrowed segment. So you would try and get a long internal iliac. In many cases, you would not be able to swing the internal iliac. Then I would harvest the internal iliac artery as a graft and suture it to the end of this renal artery and plug that onto the side of the common or the external iliac. That would normally give enough length to reach right up to the hilum.
Thank you, Firoz. Professor Dr. Anish Srivastav, how does an artery with renal artery stenosis look from outside when you are doing a, say, open donor nephrectomy or laparoscopic donor nephrectomy and you are approaching the artery while doing the donor nephrectomy surgery? How does the artery look from outside? Does it look normal or the stricture extends to the periarterial tissue?
They look normal. They look normal. We have done quite a good number in such patients and I am in favor of taking this. Reasons have been explained. But if you try to see from outside, they would look more or less normal.
And then how do you make out whether you have crossed the renal artery stenotic segment towards the aorta or you have gone towards the hilum? How do you make out that?
Well, in this case, as you can see, there is enough length, you know, before the stenosis. And therefore, you can just go comfortably, put your clips and then take it out. And then once it is on the bench, then you can decide. So it is very safe and easy in this case, I would say.
Okay.
Can I add one thing, sir, if you don't mind?
Atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis in donors. Do you have some hesitation in taking those elderly atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis, or it is one and same thing for you, a younger FMD versus a elderly atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis?
Well, as we have discussed, FMD, we all have to be little more careful whether the patient is younger or elderly. Of course, the elderly gives you the margin is larger, or it is more safe if you are doing a patient who has FMD and he is quite elderly. Because here, if you see it, FMD radiologically doesn't look like FMD at all. And we have seen this in the younger females, and the radiological typical bead-like sign is very, very typical in FMD.
So thank you very much, sir. No risk. Yeah. With that, we finish this first session or first segment of our scientific program. We now proceed to the next segment, that is anterior ureteroneocystostomy. And I quickly request Dr. Raina to share his video and share his presentation why he does not put a stent in anterior ureteroneocystostomy. Dr. Raina, unmute yourself and present your video, sir. Dr. Raina, you can unmask yourself.
Okay, thank you. You can see me now. I
cannot give you corona online.
Okay, thank you very much for asking me to speak, Ajay. And we made this video last week when we were doing a transplant of a patient at Jesloc Hospital. And let me give you greetings from all my colleagues in the hospital. Can you see my video now?
No, sir.
One second. Can you see it now?
No, sir. We can see your presentation, but not your video.
I don't know why. One second.
Nitesh, can you
take control
of Dr. Raina's laptop remote control and then open his video? Nitesh.
I'll go, sir, Nitesh.
Yeah. Close the PowerPoint and just play the video. No?
Dr. Raina, just click on this video.
Can you see it now?
No, you have to click on this MP4 video.
I don't know. We saw it nicely yesterday.
Dr. Nitesh, can you take remote control of Dr. Raina's laptop?
We may have to share it again.
You have to share the link to me, sir. Any desk link.
No. You request remote control.
Oh, God.
It's opening.
Can you see it now?
Dilesh, are you seeing it play on your computer?
Okay,
Raina, stop sharing and share again.
On your computer.
Share again. Okay, share
Listen,
again.
Listen, do one thing. You stop sharing first and share. After, open the video and share again. Stop sharing. Open the video. Share again.
Ajay, otherwise you can go to Sanjay Sureka and then come back to...
Okay. Sanjay Sureka, please present your argument why you put in a stent in anterior ureteroneocystostomy, please. Dr. Raina, meanwhile, sort out your problem.
Hey, what is this? You can't hear me now? Okay.
Yeah, Sanjay.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, please.
My slides are visible?
Yes.
Right, sir. So why there is a age-old debate regarding the issue? So there is a probable potential benefit for stenting, which may include reduce early major urological complications like obstruction or leak, and at the cost of some potential harm, which may be perceived, like increased risk of UTI, complications and side effects related to stents, like stent-related irritations, malposition, and additional cost. So I would like to focus, why is the debate? There are definitive roles of stent in cases of abnormal bladder, like previously operated dysfunctional bladder, neurogenic bladder, or when there is a technical difficulties during intraoperative anastomosis. And we definitely know that it does not prevent long-term major ischemia-related complications. So there is no debate for long-term stenosis prevention. So the debate is the routine prophylactic stenting for early prevention of major urological complication. So with the basis of evidence, I will discuss this point, the role of reduce early urological complication, stent-related morbidity and timing of stent removal and graft function. So if I look into the pathophysiology of early urinary complications, because of immunosuppression, sometimes technical failure or to some extent ischemia may increase the risk of urological urinary leaks, and kinking, blood clots, edema or perigraft collection may cause mechanical obstruction and which may increase the morbidity. So there is a the largest series which published was Cochrane Review, which was published in 2013, and they have looked into the incidence of major urological complication in a patient with stent and without stent. And they found that only one study, they included seven study and more than 1200 odd patients. And in one study, there was no difference. And rest of the study, there was a significant positive impact of stenting to prevent the urological complication. And then they have looked into combined urinary leak and obstruction, and stent favors to reduce both this complication in combined incidence. And when they looked into urinary leak and ureteric obstruction separately, and this forest plot also favors for stenting. And I also looked into individual literature, some published recently, which also suggest there is definitive advantage to prevent early urinary leak with the stent. However, the stenosis does not have major impact by stenting. Except one study, there was on favor of stenting for preventing stenosis. Otherwise, there was no impact. So at least it reduces the leak. So when I looked into the UTI rate, there are some studies which said that there is increased risk of UTI, but many studies also suggested that comparable UTI rate in stent and non-stented group. So I looked into in details how the stenting has done with the indwelling time. If we see that when the stenting time was less than 1 month, there was no increased incidence of urinary tract infection. And there is one prospective randomized control trial which was published in 2017. And they have compared early stent removal versus delayed stent removal, and they conclude that early stent removal does not increase the risk of UTI. And one study is published from our center where we have removed stent between 10 to 14 days, and we found it reduces the early urinary leak additional and decrease the risk of additional intervention, as well as reduce the repeat hospitalization without additional cost. I looked into the graft function and patient morbidity. Stent does not increase the long-term graft function and stent morbidity as suggested in the Cochrane review. And the long-term graft function was also comparable in majority of the literature, though it's not included in many literature has studied this fact, but stenting is safe in terms of graft function. So to conclude with, evidence supports prophylactic stenting and to reduce the early major urological complication. Early stent removal does not increase the morbidity and safe in regards to graft function.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay. Dr. Raina, aapka video chalu ho sakta hai?
Yes, please. Or sir, Raina sir can present his debate first, then video. Because
yeah, that is a good option. Dr. Raina, please present your side why you do not put a stent routinely, and then we can try the video.
Okay, the video is working, hopefully now. Are you able to see my video now?
We are seeing your presentation, Dr. Raina. We are not seeing your video.
It is coming now, I think.
I think your presentation has started.
Can you see the video?
Yes. Yeah.
All right. First, the point here is no stent. It's not about how I do it. It's no stent. So from that, the first thing, of course, we always have to find out that the donor is a part. The donor and the recipient surgeons work in cohorts. And we make sure that the ureter, while it's being removed, is removed carefully and there is no arterial injury. And then when we perfuse the kidney, we have to make sure that when the donor ureter is being removed, it's fully vascularized and there's a good output. Next, go back, go forward. Then when we are perfusing the kidney, we have to make sure that the fat around the ureter is well vascularized. The ureter is vascularized. And then when we are putting the kidney inside the We do the anastomosis with the kidney in place. We do not rotate the kidney so that we don't have to stretch the ureter at all. Go on. Then after the artery is anastomosed and it's released, go on. And we get a good kidney and we get a wet anastomosis, which means the ureter is well perfused, the kidney is well perfused. What we do is we spatulate the posterior part. We make sure that the ureter is not too long and not too short. I always believe that the ureteric peristalsis is what is important to throw the urine out into the bladder. After this is done, and we make sure that we inflate the bladder first with betadine and then with air. Our anastomosis is done on the dome on the anterior lateral side. We do a detrusor myotomy and we dissect the mucosa very carefully of the detrusor. We don't take out all the fascia from the uterine mucosa. We don't want a very thin mucosa. We have a good detrusor myotomy so that when we are suturing and making a tunnel, we get a proper amount of the detrusor. We take a silk stitch on the detrusor, and this silk stitch as a retraction. It also acts later on when we close the detrusor, we close this silk to identify where we have done the ureter. We make a nick on the bladder mucosa. We stretch it with forceps, and then we anastomose the ureter first. We see the length. Our length should not be too short or too long. We use 5-0 PDS. However, if it's a very thin bladder mucosa, we can also use a 6-0 PDS. And we take continuous sutures. While we are doing the sutures, we take first the bladder mucosa and then the mucosa of the ureter. We make sure that the lateral is done first and then the medial. We do not stent it right now. It's after we have done the lateral side. Then we put a feeding tube. Some people can even put a right angle clamp, but we prefer to put the feeding tube while we are doing on the laterals, on the medial side. So that's the way it is done. This is a wet anastomosis. There's good output in the ureter from the kidney, and we do not push and tug in any way. Go forward here. Now here we have kept the feeding tube. We have put the feeding tube in the ureter. This is doing the medial side. It's here that this is the only time we use this stent, is just to make sure that we do a decent wide anastomosis. The length of the ureter which we spatulate is between 1.5 to 2 centimeters. We do not do a very big spatulation. After it's all done and carefully done with the 5-0 PDS, in the good old days, we sometimes even use proline, but which was a mistake. Now it's all PDS. Then we take the sutures and we put those sutures under the detrusor muscle, as you can see. And this fixes the ureter. Then we inflate the bladder to make sure that there's no leak. Once there's no leak, we are quite confident that this is a well-vascularized ureter. This is a ureter which does not require a stent. And then, of course, we close the detrusor muscle on top. Uh, after it is done, go slightly ahead. We then make sure that there is, we close the detrusor, we make sure that there is no, and this urine has a good output. We don't want it tight. At the same time, we want the ureter with all its fat all the time. And we also make sure that the cord does not compress the ureter. Even when you do a robotic or a laparoscopic donor nephrectomy, you make sure that you have the fat all along the ureter. So are uretric double J stents frequently used in modern? They are, but in transplants, it's debatable. Over the last, I think, 25 years that I'm with this transplant unit at the Durslow Hospital, we've hardly used double J stents. And we've never used it? Yes, we have, in abnormal bladders, which have a blood supply to the ureter is compromised. When there's a dry anastomosis, in diseased kidneys, prolonged ischemia time, arterial injuries, EU will recommend the placement of a double J stent prophylactically by performing ureteroscopy. But remember, there are disease donors. Is it worthwhile? Can it be avoided? Of course, as I've just shown you, if you've got a proper vascularity, the renal recipient surgeon perfuses the kidney. He is a part of the donor team also to make sure that it's no arterial injury to the donor, the kidney is firm, and which comes to the recipient, the kidney is placed and anastomosed. The results of this study have shown that it's not worthwhile. Stenting should be limited to patients with pathological or a defunctionized bladder. Intraoperative risk of urinary infection is there. Stone formation is there. And in stones, you know what happens. UTI, reflux, migration, and constriction in stones. The most common factor is a nephrostomy tube. And here the alum stent being used in the stricture. And you can see, even this has not grown this system. Earlier, we had choline, and that's why we had stone formation, but not in the ureter, in the prolapse, looking into the bladder. Here is a double J stent.
Dr. Rana, just a minute. Dr. Rana, just a minute. I request everyone else to mute themselves. We are hearing some domestic noises in the background. Proceed, Dr. Rana. Sorry to interrupt you.
Not at all. So when you have double J stent encrusted with stones in transplant kidneys, we do a PCA to remove the stent and to crush the stone. But remember, these kidneys, after some time, they are very fibrous because of the immunosuppression that they are taking. And it's not the easiest thing to puncture a kidney transplant in the anterior calyx and to dilate it because they are really tough. The specific factors that favor progression to PVN are not well defined, but first, a second hit is necessary for progression to polymorphous nephropathy. Remember, the study has revealed a normal association between stent placement and the subsequent development of PVN and raises the possibility that ureteral trauma from stent placement may predispose to PVN. In short ureters, there is no question of double J stents in short ureters. I don't think Guari flap should be done in transplant unless it's a large bladder, good mucosa, and very short Guari flap. Otherwise, pyloureterostomy is the thing. Swatch hitch doesn't really help. For ureteric defects longer than 6 to 8, which cannot be bridged, Guari flap offers. The double J stent at the time of lymphocele formation could protect renal function by preventing ureteric compression. Hey, the moment a stent is out, this lymphocele is going to press the ureter again. So I do not think double J stents prevent lymphocele from compression. Renal transplants in the COVID time also that we have done, if you've seen, we've never used double J stents except in cadaveric transplants. So at the Durslow Hospital, over the last 30 years that I'm associated with this transplant team, we have not put double J stents in more than 2 to 5% patients. I thank you for a patient hearing.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Rana and Dr. Sanjay, for nice debates.
So I'm telling you, double J stent is not mandatory. This is my rebuttal. Stents not only has an innate complication of LUTS and hematuria, but also a high incidence of UTI. Placing a stent cannot, and I repeat, cannot be a substitute for surgical technique. I'm not against the use of BJ stent, but I'm against the indiscriminate use of BJ stent in renal transplant patients. As I am also against the indiscriminate use of antibiotics and the indiscriminate use of foreign materials. I rest my case. Thank you, Dr. Oswal, for inviting me.
Thank you very much, Dr. Raina. I have few quick questions.
Sir, I have a rebuttal, sir. Sir, I have
okay, a rebuttal. Please proceed. Please proceed.
Sir, you have to stop screen sharing, sir.
Dr. Raina, stop sharing your screen. Sorry, Sanjay, I had forgotten your rebuttal. Sorry for that.
No, not an issue. So I'll drive little deep to highlight the Eastern related issues as discussed by Raina sir.
Quick, sir.
If we see the kidney is denervated in transplanted, so reduced stent does not increase the reflex related pain, and because the stent is short and anteriorly placed, so it does not increase the risk of trigeminal irritation. If we see the incrustation rate, as in this study, two studies have showed that there was a high risk of incrustation, but there was indwelling time of more than 2 months almost. And the migration and malpositioning was also high in one study, while they have used a larger size stone. And the irritative symptoms was higher in two study, and they also kept the stent for more than 2 weeks. So probably it does not increase morbidity except mild stent-related symptoms in some studies. And if we see the symptomatic versus asymptomatic bacteria, the culture-positive UTI, culture-positive asymptomatic bacteria is probably higher with stent, but symptomatic UTI does not increase in patient with stent as per the literature. And if we see when the proper antibiotic was given, the antibiotic, the stent does not increase the risk of UTI, symptomatic UTI. And also there's a recently published paper which looked into the independent risk factor of UTI, and they did not find any association with the double J stent. The urologic complication after transplantation was the most important independent risk factor, which can be prevented by the stent. So if we see the cost analysis, the one patient for treating the complication can be managed with 23 or 22 patient of stenting. So cost is not an issue. So what is the treatment of ureteric leak or early ureteric complication is de-stenting. So I would say you should wear proper mask to prevent third wave, even if you are well vaccinated. And if you are still not very convinced, you can see this Bhojpuri movie, Shabdhani Hati To Durghatana Ghati. And jara dekhke chalo bhai. And at last, I want to have a good sleep after transplantation. So to conclude with, there is no alternative of tension-free anastomosis with good blood vascular supply. Routine prophylactic stenting reduces the major urological complication early. At least the leak does not increase symptomatic UTI if we remove the stent early with proper antibiotic coverage. Prophylactic stenting benefit overweighs the possible morbidity. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, both the debaters, for making strong arguments. Dr. Raina, I have a few questions for you. Dr. Raina, where are you?
Yeah, I'm here.
Dr. Raina, how fastidious are you about making a good long anti-refluxing tunnel?
See, my anti-reflux, the fact that I'm fastidious, but not very fastidious, because my anastomosis is practically at the dome, anterolateral aspect of the dome. There, reflux hardly matters. Secondly, I don't make a tunnel of more than 3 centimeters. But I do make an anti-reflux tunnel.
Okay. There is a question from audience. If you have multiple renal arteries, one of them lower polar separate artery, then would you insist on putting in a stent?
If I have multiple renal arteries and I have a long time taken for my anastomosis and I do not have a wet anastomosis, but the patient kidney is at ATN for some time, yes, I will put a stent.
Okay, thank you very much. What is your preferred suture material, Dr. Raina?
I use a 5-0 PDS 13mm needle. However, if the bladder mucosa is very thin, then I will use a 6-0 PDS.
There is one more interesting question from the audience. Can ICG be used to see ureter vascularity intraoperatively? Well, no, I find that question.
I think that is beautifully sat on paper. But in practicality, if you've got, as I've shown, a good fat while I'm perfusing the kidney, a good fat while the kidney is placed in the fossa, then I don't think one requires that to be a, you know, a kill too far.
Thank you very much.
I don't think that is.
Thank you. Dr. Sanjay, what is the size of your stent you recommend for your transplants?
4x16 cent.
So if you use 16 centimeters while removal, you will be struggling. It will be at the roof and you will have to bend your scope too much to remove that 16 centimeters.
We never had an issue for removing the stent.
Okay. So what is the duration of your stent in practice?
10 to 14 days, sir.
And you have never faced leak or stenosis in stented anastomosis?
It's not right, sir. It's not always the case, because in cases of, we have rarely seen cases with some vascular issues or major necrosis, there may be leak, but we rarely see, we have seen the leak with an stent in situ.
What is your preferred suture material?
Sir, PDS-50.
Thank you very much. Professor Sunil Shroff, are you there? Please unmute.
I joined a little late. Thank you.
Sir, please enlighten us with your wisdom, tips and tricks of doing a transplant anterior ureteral cystostomy, but be quick.
I think, you know, it's very well illustrated by Salesh. I don't think so. The technique itself has a huge challenge. Of course, there are many variables. That's why, you know, you have all this debate. The variables are the donor surgery, the recipient surgery, how much you handle, the golden triangle, you know, how you handle the ureter. One of the things which I would like to say, in checking the blood supply of the ureter, when you're actually trimming the ureter and when you cut the ureter, and if you see a little bit of blood, you know, kind of small trickle somewhere coming out, that means that your ureter is well vascularized for sure. You know, so, you know, when you're trimming, just be very observant on when you're trimming the fat and you're trimming the, you know, fascia, whether you're getting that little, you know, little wet area of which indicates that, yes, there is a good blood supply. So that's one of the ways by which, you know, somebody who's starting transplants can check the ureteric end and do the minimum handling, you know, of the ureteric end when you're actually doing anastomosis. Don't use anything, you know, other than, you know, a DeBakey forceps or something like that. I always tell my assistants that that is the key, especially if you're assisting your, this one, assisting your, you know, surgeon. I use 3 sutures, 1 at the apex and 2 at the base, before 3 interrupted sutures before actually I start. But interrupted sutures meaning that I do the interrupt, you know, I actually don't tie them to the very end so that I can actually, you know, lift the ureter and see I'm not taking the other wall and so on. So I put 3 sutures and I triangulate the anastomosis and then I start the anastomosis. As usual, like what everybody has said, a continuous anastomosis. Given the choice, I will always use a stent because I like the last slide, what Sanjay showed. I like to sleep well and I don't want waking up. And to be honest, I have never been woken up in my transplant career so far. And one of the reasons is, routinely, when I started my transplant program in India, I used to use stent. You know, do remember the Cochrane studies are based on mostly deceased donor studies, except for the one from Sanjay Gandhi, which was published by Anand Kumar, a very good study. Most of the studies are deceased donor study. And we have agreed on this point in India now that in all deceased donor kidneys, we will put a stent. So on, whereas in India, our large experience is with living related. And living transplants, usually kidney transplants, they are wet. On the table, you see a lot of urine. So, you know, you are a little bit less inclined to put in another foreign body. And I do understand this point that routinely you may not require a stent, but you can never predict a transplant. The best of transplants, the easiest of transplants can go wrong anytime. So my preference, to be honest, is routinely use a stent. Take it out within 2 weeks. Absolutely no problem. You have flexible, you know, cystoscopes now available. Use a flexible instrument to take it out. It hardly takes 5 minutes. Doesn't increase the morbidity to the patient. Doesn't increase the cost great deal. 500-600 rupees of extra cost. It doesn't matter when the patient is paying more than 5 lakhs for your transplant. So I don't think the cost is a barrier there. I think the key is your understanding, and making sure that one early complication is avoided by putting a stent. And most important, you sleep well in the night. That's very important for me after a long.
Sir, what is your preferred suture material?
To be honest, I used to, you know, use Vicryl 40 for a long time, and I do use PDS as well. I have no great preference as such. I think both the suture materials are equally good as long as your technique is right. As long as, you know, you make sure, you know, you're done, you know, the best you can with minimum handling of the university gadgets.
Thank you, sir. Professor Anish, you want to say something, please.
Yeah, I would say that we are all, you know, insisting on the technique. Yes, we must. And we all do, you know, experienced surgeons do it very well. But I would say that it is not only the technique. It is the way the kidney has been harvested, in a, especially in a live related situation, whether the ureteric triangle has been preserved or not. It does definitely have a meaning. It goes a very, very long way. So that is one important point. That's why, besides other things, we prefer to put the stent. And in our multivariate analysis for the ureteric leak, we have very, very few cases. In last 700 transplants, I think only 7 cases had issues. And we looked at the multivariate analysis and ABO incompatible, which we have done more than 150. So we found that that was a risk factor, ABO incompatible transplant. And lastly, I would like to say that if you read the latest Campbell's textbook of urology, so the author there has very nicely summarized the studies, meta-analysis, and then concluded that it is always a safe practice to put a...
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. Dr. Sabnis, please tell us how much bladder should be filled while doing the anterior ureteroneocystostomy.
About 100 to 150 cc's. It is sufficient enough. There is no hard and fast rule like that.
Yes.
But it is sufficient enough for you to see that bladder when you are taking the incision on the bladder is properly filled up.
And how fastidious you are about making a good long tunnel anti-refluxing anastomosis? How fastidious?
Adequate proper tunnel is very important. I think I will agree with Raina what answer he gave. And actually, this debate of stent versus no stent will continue forever because everybody has their own practice. But we have been, I think I totally agree with what Raina has said, that we are not putting the stent regularly. Maybe about 10-15% do require stent, but not as a regular. And one important thing, when we talk of complications which are less with the stent versus no stent study, a bad technique, improper donor retrieval, improper handling of the ureter, the fat which is not there, skeletonizing ureter, all these complications, bad technique cannot be compensated by the putting a stent. If the complications are going to occur because of this, they are bound to occur in spite of stent. And those minor things which are likely to happen and will take care by stent, in any case, they don't need any intervention. They will be taken care as time progresses.
Thank you, Dr. Sabnis. Dr. Firoz, you had taught me ureteric anastomosis. So tell us, how long should the catheter be kept per urethral catheter?
Our practice is to remove it on the fourth day, latest fifth day, unless there is some overriding reason to keep it.
If on fourth postoperative day or fourth, fifth postoperative day, he still continues to pour urine, say 10 liters per day, even then will you remove the catheter?
I think if he's continuing to pour urine long before the fourth or fifth day, we would have taken action. And keeping the Foley's catheter longer is unlikely to... You're talking of urine leak, I presume?
No. Pouring urine per urethral Foley catheter, he is having output of more than 10 liters per urethra Foley catheter. No urine leak.
I would still remove it. I would not be unduly worried about the anastomosis leaking at that point.
He would have to go to toilet every now and then, every 15 minutes with that much of output. Will he not be visiting toilet every 15 minutes?
I think it's very rare for that level of diuresis to persist beyond the third, fourth day. And even with a diuresis of more than 5 liters per 24 hours, the anastomosis itself should not be in jeopardy. The anastomosis heals surprisingly well, despite that patient being immunocompromised. We have had patients where the catheters have slipped out on the third day. We have not reintroduced them. Also, we don't routinely make it a practice to put a stent. We use them very sparingly. I think this Cochrane database, you have to take the results with a pinch of salt. If you see their urological complications in non-stented patients range from 0 to 17%, which is alarmingly high. In stented patients, it is 0 to 4%. In most large volume centers, which are routinely not leaving a stent, incidence of urological complications is as it is less than 2-3%. So these 0 to 18% are very high. And there is a subgroup caveat even in the Cochrane database, which says that the when they took out the single center studies or the single surgeon studies, large volume studies, in those the benefit of putting a stent was much lesser, which means when you have someone who has a larger experience, has been doing these routinely, the incidence of major urological complications, even if unstented, is not higher. And in those patients, the benefit of putting a stent will be much less. And then you will come across all the side effects of putting a stent. Even in the Cochrane database, incidence of urine infections is 50% more. Relative risk is 1.5%. So many other complications.
Thank you, Firoz. Do you have any protocol of drain removal vis-a-vis Foley catheter removal? Would you always remove drain after removal of Foley catheter, or drain is strictly on the merit of its quantity?
I think largely the drain is on the merit of its quantity. Typically, as I said, our protocol is to remove the Foleys on the fourth or fifth day. And typically the drain comes out 1 to 2 days after that. Occasionally, if the drain output is more than 100 or 150 by the fifth or sixth day, then obviously we would keep it longer till it reduces.
Thank you. Professor Abraham, Georgie Abraham, please tell us, guide us about doing ureteric anastomosis in small defunctionalized bladder and neurogenic bladders. Quickly, sir, brief.
The detrusor thickness is there, and mobilization also becomes little difficult. And we have to do an adequate detrusorrhaphy has to be done. The mucus has to be mobilized just like other, but technically it will be little difficult. Muscles are very thick. So we have to do anastomosis as usual, but it is technically difficult, challenging.
So would your decision of stenting or no stenting depend on the normality or abnormality of bladder also?
See, I fully agree with the points mentioned by Dr. Sanjay. And I am in favor of stenting in all ureteric reimplantations, because those points are well taken. We want to sleep comfortably. We want to early complication has to be avoided.
Thank you very much, sir. With that, we conclude the second part of our debates. So now we proceed with the next part, that is case-based discussion.
Hey, can I just say one point, if it's okay with you?
Quick, sir, please.
Okay. Everybody said sleep well, sleep well, sleep well. Let me tell you, if you're doing diseased donors, you're not going to sleep well, whether you put a stent or you don't put a stent. Because diseased donors mostly at night, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock.
Salesh, at least next day you sleep well, yaar.
That's right. Thank you, Dr. Oswal.
Thank you, sir. Vikas, let us move on with case-based discussion. Your first case, please.
Sir, you can see my slides as well.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Nitesh and Oswal, sir, for giving me this opportunity.
Because just one small request. Please allow me to interrupt your presentation and allow me to ask questions to you as well as the experts.
Right, sir. Okay. So next half an hour or so, we'll be dealing some few cases on ureteric complications. I'll be presenting the cases. So our first case is, the donor is 31-year-old female. She had 2 renal arteries on each side and bilateral single renal veins. Her recipient is mother. She was hypertensive and had ESRD. And she had history of right nephrectomy for stone disease. So this is the image you can see, got 2 bilateral dual renal arteries. So my question to Dr. Anish Srivastav, sir, has already explained well. So what is the significance of this lower polar artery as far as the ureteric blood supply is concerned, sir?
So Vikas, yes, it is very, very important, as we all know, that this artery contributes to the major portion of the, especially the blood supply going towards the lower end of the ureter. It has its own importance. And in such cases, we must, what I would suggest is just a small point, that if you do an anastomosis to the internal iliac artery, you always need a longer length of ureter. or the because the kidney tends to go higher up.
Higher.
Whereas if you use external iliac artery, and if you put it, you know, towards the caudal end of the patient, then you need a maybe sometimes up to 2 centimeter smaller ureter. As you might have seen, Dr. Shailesh Raina's slide, there was a very long ureter there because he put in the stone. So I say it is very important and crucial for us to do a good anastomosis to this artery.
So you have to give a good anastomosis to this artery. You cannot underestimate the importance of this artery while doing an anastomosis. So this patient had uneventful laparoscopic left donor nephrectomy. Induction was basiliximab, methylprednisolone. Anastomosis was done. The main renal artery was anastomosed to the external iliac artery, and this small artery went to the internal inferior epigastric artery. I always do an stented anterior ureteroneocystectomy. Good urine output. Nadir creatinine was 1.08 milligram per deciliter. Graft DJ stent was removed after 3 weeks. That is my standard. At 3 months, she presented to us with fever, sudden rise in serum creatinine to 3.23 milligram per deciliter. Her output was also reduced from 4 liters to 1.5 liters, and her counts was there. The TAC level was normal. Sabni sir.
Yes.
What next, sir? What is going in your mind when she came back to you after 3 months?
First thing is we need to do ultrasound to see what exactly is happening, whether there is any hydronephrosis, whether there is any collection. So ultrasound will decide what is your further course of action.
Sir, can it be just sepsis? Her counts were 14,200.
It could be, but ultrasound will give you idea if there is any collection, if there is any hydronephrosis, because 3 months are passed. Why suddenly she should get this sepsis all of a sudden?
So this is the ultrasound. You can see, sir, it's got moderate hydronephrosis. Even the upper ureter was dilated. The RI was raised. And peak systolic velocity is also on the higher side, while the segmental renal arteries are normal. So what is your differential diagnosis at this point, sir, after seeing the ultrasound? Are you dealing with the obstruction or you're dealing with the arterial problem?
No collection anywhere.
No collection, sir, nothing. This is the finding, sir.
And any serial ultrasound done before the hydronephrosis is increased, or it is same?
Because sir,
implant, most of the time there is hydronephrosis, which is
always. This is a 3 months, sir. This is a 3 months she had come for a regular follow-up, and you find that the creatinine is 3.23, and these are.
But the ultrasonographic dilatation, what you are showing, is it increased now or it is same right from day one?
It is a new finding, sir. It was not there earlier, sir.
If it is new finding, then I would give a lot of significance to this. And first, my differential diagnosis would be obstruction.
Obstruction?
Because, sir.
When
you see hydronephrosis and hydroureter, why are you thinking of vascular problems at all?
Sir, I was also very sure that I am dealing with obstruction, but these Doppler findings confused me a bit because the RI was on the higher side. So my question is whether you can get these findings in obstruction as well.
No, because if you have the interstitial edema, your RI is bound to increase.
Okay.
So RI increase suggests that there is some interstitial edema.
Okay. So this is important point to understand that these findings, Doppler findings, can go in favor of obstruction, which can give rise to interstitial edema and subsequently these findings. Sir, Shroff, sir. Dr. Sunil Shroff, sir.
Bolo.
Sir, next what?
I'm also worried about the fever here. You know, have you done a urine culture?
Sir, already been sent, sir. Already been sent, sir. And she was started on IV antibiotics, sir.
Okay. So you definitely want to treat the sepsis if it is there.
Okay.
And then do any intervention. You want to see if there is an obstruction. And also do sometimes it does make a little difference to see post-void how much of hydronephrosis is residual. So
this is persisting even after.
Yeah, sure. I'm just giving, what I would have been doing when I get such a case.
Okay.
And then after that, you know, with the creatinine having gone up 3.23, whether, you know, with consultation with my nephrologist, I would also look at, you know, whether there is some degree of rejection going on here, to be sure in mind. Because are we very sure that the creatinine has gone up to 3.3? Is it due to sepsis? Is it due to hydronephrosis and obstruction? Or, you know, it is due to rejection? I mean, these are your three usual things. But you said the RI is high, and as Sabnis said, that, you know, with a little bit of edema and with a little bit of early rejection, you may get a similar picture as well. So, you know, there is a little mixed picture. But if there is an obstruction, definitely it needs to be treated. I would, you know, in the order of, you know, ruling out, I would like to rule out sepsis first before I, you know, jump into this. And after I've ruled out sepsis, and once the sepsis has subsided, then I would, you know, also, you know, then look at the creatinine. If the creatinine is not improved, then I may be tempted to do a biopsy. And only third, in that my level of kind of differential, I'll come to obstruction and look at how to treat this obstruction. This is my approach to this. Sir, I'm sure there are many ways to...
Professor Shroff. Professor Shroff.
Yes.
When you are seeing obvious hydronephrosis and hydroureter, which was not there earlier, why are you thinking of medical causes first and obstruction last?
We do see some degree of hydronephrosis in post-transplant kidneys. It's not unusual to see hydronephrosis in normal creatinine as well. We all know that.
Sir, so, this kind of hydronephrosis, sir, I don't think
because I'm not saying that, you know, this is, you know, you feel it's significant, but I have also seen hydronephrosis of this level with a borderline creatinine as well. Okay. I mean, what I'm trying to say is that, you know, it is there, but it is not so gross to be, you know, kind of so concerned. But what I'm trying to say is, yes, this will require treatment. This will require to be, you know, differentiated. All I'm saying is I would keep these three things in my mind and rule this out before I treat the hydronephrosis and look for obstruction and treat the obstruction is what I'm saying. I'm not saying that I won't treat the obstruction, but I would definitely want to, you know, look at these factors as well before I treat the obstruction.
Correct, sir.
Is what I'm saying.
Taken that, we'll have to have some deficient diagnosis as well, looking at the entire picture.
And the sepsis is definitely there. She's not a diabetic. You know, her fever is there. Count is a little raised. Creatinine has gone up. So I definitely have worry that if I intervene at this stage, I may even make the things worse by making a puncture in the kidney or whatever I want to do. So I definitely want to treat the sepsis thing and get it out of my way before I actually jump into this. But if there is, you know, if it is not subsiding, if the fever still persists and the hydronephrosis persists, then I'll be tempted to do something at that stage. You know what I mean? For at least three, four days of treatment is warranted before I start doing anything to the kidney, like puncturing the kidney or whatever I want to do.
Okay. Sir, Dr. Georgi Abram, what next? How do you proceed, sir?
I am in favor of an obstruction there because recently a significantly dilated PCS and ureter. Okay. So a retrograde stenting may be a little difficult, but still we can try. Sometimes we may be successful. Failing which, an anti-grade ultrasound guided puncture and anti-grade stenting has to be done first and give time to recover and see how the kidney function is improved.
Okay, sir. I agreed with you that we decided to put do a puncture under antibiotic cover and plan to place a PCN. I was not in favor of doing a anti-grade DG stenting at this point of time as the patient was in sepsis. So I thought I would just put in a PCN and come out and let the creatinine settle and take a call later, sir. So this is what is done. And I gently did...
Because why not stent?
Sir, that is what I explained. Because she was in sepsis, the counts were on the higher side. So just to tie over the crisis under local anesthesia, I just put in a PCN and came out. Okay. And yes, somebody can agree that they try putting a DJ stunt, which I did not do at this point. Okay.
Was the urine clear when you punctured?
Sir, it was turbid, but not frank pus.
Yeah.
And as you can see, I did a gentle dye study and the contrast was not going below the upper ureter. Even the guide wire could not be passed. So I did not do much at this point of time, just put in a PCR and came out.
And how many days of antibody you gave before you punctured her?
Sir, 2 days, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. PCR culture came out as E. coli. Yeah. Post obstruction release, she had good diuresis and the creatinine came down to 1.13, sir.
Wait a minute. Dr. Sabnis, are there any technical tips to put in a stent in a transplanted ureter?
What Vikas did, we would have done the same thing. Only thing is that if the once you put up a PCN needle and you get turbid urine, we would not put even the contrast because putting contrast itself can cause aggravation of sepsis. We would just put a wire. If it goes easily in the ureter, if the thing goes, then we would just put anti-grade DJ and at the same time put a PCN also. So your therapy also is done and your diversion also is done. But by any means, if there is any difficulty in wire going across and is that, we would just put PCN, allow this patient the sepsis to be cleared up. There is always, you can try it next time. There is no problem
at all. The question I wanted to ask was, are there any specific tips and tricks to put in a retrograde stent in transplant?
Retrograde stenting, generally we don't do it. We generally put it anterograde. Because retrograde, generally it is very difficult. Anterior stem, ureterostomy is sometimes difficult to find out. So in a dilated system like this, we feel that anterograde stenting is quicker, far easier, and without any problem.
Okay, Vikas, proceed. Sorry to interrupt.
In a female, you know, retrograde stenting is much easier than in a male, generally.
Sir, Firoz, sir, my next question to you. Sir, when do you plan for a definitive procedure in this patient, either in the same setting or you wait for some more time, sir? And what procedure?
I think there's no question that a definitive procedure you would not do at this sitting. What you have is an infected system which you have just drained. Initial nephrostomogram is showing a near complete cutoff just below the PU junction. There is a length of dilated upper ureter that you can see. Nothing is going beyond that. The first step would be to just keep the nephrostomy in place, continue the antibiotic cover, and maybe a week later, I would repeat the nephrostomogram.
Okay.
You will see contrast going down the ureter. There is clearly no complete obstruction because till you put this in, the patient was passing 1.8 liters of urine per day. So often there is a lot of edema due to the infection. Once you let that settle, when you repeat the nephrostomogram, you may be able to, this may be amenable to intervention, non-open.
So, as you correctly said, sir, definitely we should wait in such patients who present to you with high counts and sepsis. That's what we also did, but I had a bit different opinion as far as the nephrostogram was concerned, because in the first attempt, when I tried to pass the guide wire, I was not sure that even the second time I would get a good nephrostogram. The dye will go to the ureter.
I would do the nephrostomogram even the first time around. When you find the complete obstruction, you leave a nephrostomy and come out. I would repeat the nephrostomogram a week later after the sepsis has settled. And often what is a complete obstruction on the initial nephrostomogram may not be a complete obstruction when you do it 7 to 10 days later.
Agreed, sir. That point is very well taken.
As from the left lower corner, you forward the
left. Okay.
Press the arrows. So, sir,
in this particular case, because I had initial problems in passing, I was not very sure whether I will be able to get a good. I will be able to pass a guide wire. So I properly planned this after 3 weeks with the plan of stricture dilatation as well as ureteric reconstruction. With that in mind, I proceeded and admitted the patient after 3 weeks. And on table when I was doing, this is the finding that I got, sir. So Anish Srivastav, sir. So
yes,
the patient is on table. You have taken consent for both endourologic intervention as well as the ureteric reconstruction. So now how do you proceed? This is the nephrostogram after 3 weeks.
Yeah, Vikas, generally, if it is a small segment, I would prefer a good balloon dilatation, if the guide wire can go in. But this is a long segment stricture.
Yes,
so
sir.
Here I would be hesitant to go for a balloon dilatation or an endourological management. We can discuss with the patient. The chances are very high that, you know, this patient, despite dilatation and putting a stent, would, you know, again come back.
Okay,
so
sir.
If he says no, doctor, please do minimally invasive first time, then only in this long segment ureteric stricture, if the guide wire passes, I'm going to take a chance. Otherwise, I would like to go for.
So I think sir, everybody will agree that this is a long segment stricture and probably will not be amenable to endourological management. We'll have to go ahead and do a ureteric reconstruction, whatever we want to do.
Yeah.
Okay. Sir, this is the same time I did a cystoscopy, and these are the findings on the cystoscopy, which were not, we did not know about these findings prior to this. Sir. So there were multiple soft plaque-like lesions all over the bladder, including the neo-ureteric orifice. So, Sapni sir, any idea about these lesions? What it could be, sir?
So you need to take the biopsy, see whether there is the fungal infection or not.
Correct, sir.
And evaluate what exactly. Yeah.
So you don't want to do anything at this point of time. Just do remove, take out this lesion, send for biopsy. Yeah.
Unless and until you know what exactly are these lesions, it is not appropriate to just go ahead with definitive management. There is no, sure, sir. There is no hurry at all.
Correct, sir. That is what we did. She was, she already had PCN, creatinine was normal. There was no sepsis. So we took out these lesions as much as possible. There were multiple lesions and we sent them for the biopsy and the biopsy came out as malacoplegia. There were sheets of histiocyte with granular eosinophilic vacuolated cytoplasm. You can see the Michaelis Guttmann bodies, which are pathognomic of this particular condition, sir. Shroff, sir, any, what is your opinion now, sir? It's a completely changed thing now.
With this kind of, you know, diagnosis, it's very unusual to have it, but I don't think so. It may be a deterrent to do a definitive procedure as such. You need to explain to the patient, and then, you know, obviously this is an ischemic stricture. It is not the stricture is not going to go away by just putting a stent. So you'll need some kind of a definitive procedure.
Correct.
And so you need to plan the definitive procedure and proceed accordingly.
Correct. So that is what this is an incidental finding, and definitely it's a benign condition, not a malignant one. And this patient requires further definitive treatment for stricture. Georgi, sir, what do you want to do?
So a direct reimplantation becomes a little difficult. So what my preference is for to utilize the native ureter, mobilize that native ureter that can be brought. We can do a better anastomosis, a tension-free anastomosis if possible with a native ureter anastomosis.
So that is what we also plan to go ahead and do a native ureter with the pelvis. But she had history of right nephrectomy and probably nephroureterectomy. I tried searching for the ureter, native ureter. I could not find it. There was a lot of fibrosis. And so the bladder was very close. I was able to fashion a Bowari flap and bridge the gap between the renal pelvis and the bladder. And this has done well for these patients. We had a 2 years follow-up after this thing. Stent was removed after 4 weeks. You can see the antiquated study, and she has been doing well after 2 years after the procedure. So, anybody wants to say anything? I'm ending this case, sir.
So where was the lower pole artery anastomosed? Inferior
epigastric, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
So why you did not do a native ureter, Vikas?
Sir, she had a history of right nephrectomy.
Nephrectomy was for stone disease, so ureter must be there, no?
Sir, I tried searching.
Couldn't find it.
I could not find it, sir.
Okay.
Most likely, it was also removed with the ureter, with the kidney. So, I could not find it even after searching for quite some time, sir.
And what did you do for the malacoplegia of the bladder?
Sir, this malacoplegia, just one slide, sir. This is usually found in immunocompromised conditions, and you just have to give long-term antibiotics.
Long-term antibiotics are required.
That's all. Yes, sir. We gave antibiotics for almost 1 year. And we did not repeat the cystoscopy, but definitely at 2 years, her creatinine and everything was normal, sir.
Yeah, so because what happens is that with malacoplegia of bladder, you need to give long-term antibiotics because there are eosinophils and other deposits.
Correct, sir.
And when you raise the Bowari flap, that also can undergo fibrosis and then that can cause problem. But yes, I think in your case, it worked quite well. So it was quite well done.
Thank you, sir. We'll go to the next case, sir.
Yes, sir.
This is 33-year-old male. September 2014, he had living related kidney transplant somewhere else. DGA stent was placed. He had acute rejection in the post-operative period. The serum creatinine was 1.6 milligram per deciliter. The patient was called for stent removal after 4 weeks in the same center. Stent could not be removed. Patient gave history that he was taken for a stent removal under local anesthesia. And there was a lot of struggle. The stent could not be removed. And as it was included in the ureteroneocystostomy, they actually used laser to cut the suture and remove the stent. So this is the history patient gave us, and he was well for 2 months after that. In July 2015, that is almost 9 months later, he came with recurrent episodes of fever, dysuria, right iliac fossa pain. He had decreased urine output. Serum creatinine was 7.8 milligram per deciliter, and his counts was 17,000. He had acidosis and fluid overload, so required one session of dialysis. Anish sir.
Yeah.
Sir, next, what do you want to do next, sir?
So I had ultrasound.
This is the ultrasound, sir.
Yeah. So that is what I was actually expecting. And so we need to do a PCN straight away.
Sir, just because before we proceed to PCN, I want to ask you, sir, that have you ever encountered that the stent could not be removed? It was taken in the suture.
No, actually, I don't have any such experience.
Sir, anybody?
But I have read in the literature one or two times. Cases.
Sir, anybody in the panelist had a similar situation anytime in their experience?
We had some situations where transplant patients also had forgotten stents. And there were multiple stones right in the ureter, lower ureter, upper ureter, and in the kidney. Mm-hmm. So forgotten stent problems were there even in the transplant kidney.
Okay. So this patient had a difficult stent removal. Probably it was taken into the bite, and which is definitely not a good thing to happen. It calls for a good technique and good ureteric anastomosis, as we had discussed in the previous recently. So this patient had increased graft echo. Can you appreciate that?
Yes, definitely.
So, yes. This is before putting a PCN, we also did a NCCT pelvis, which showed that the kidney had significant hydronephrosis and there were multiple calculi which were mobile and moving from ureter and the pelvis. And as you correctly said, we placed the PCN. After PCN, his creatinine came down to 3.75, which was his NADH creatinine. It did not come down below. So this explained that his echogenicity was increased and the graft was already compromised. So what do you want to do next, sir?
So now, since we have stones here, so the ideal way, and I have done a couple of cases where you can go with a flexible ureteroscope through the established track and use laser and take care of the.
Sabni sir, agreed?
First thing.
Yeah. So what I would do is that from the PCN tract, you put a wire first.
Okay.
Generally, the wire will go into the bladder. These patients are always in the supine position. So bring the wire out from the urethral end. So you have a ureter which becomes quite straight. Now you have option whether to put a ureteroscope from below. Once you have the wire at the upper end and the lower end which are tight, then by the side, you can go by the ureteroscope. You have a guide with the wire, do the laser thing. And if there are stones in the kidney, those can be tackled with the nephrostomy at a nephroscope. Either way, flexible ureteroscopy from top or from the below ureteroscope, that is much easier.
So definitely we had both the options. And I passed a double lumen catheter from the already existing tract, passed two guide wire. One was coiled in the bladder and otherwise through and through, as you correctly mentioned, sir, so that we have a track from where we can go from below also and can come from up. And I prefer to do an anti-grade. I dilated the track, placed an emplast and put in a flexible nephroscope. I was able to see all the stones. Some stones were removed with the dormia and the bigger stones were fragmented with the laser. And I did the balloon dilatation of the ureter, which could be easily done as you can see, and anti-grade DJ stent was placed. His creatinine came down to 3.89, which was his nadir creatinine. It did not come down below. And at 3 months, we did a NCCT again to confirm that he's stone free and took out the DJ stent. And this patient had recently come back for the transplant because his creatinine had progressed further. So what could be the reason for that? Is it because of the obstruction he had gone into problems, sir, or his kidney was bad to start with? Firoz, sir.
I don't think his progression to ESRD again is related to his stone disease. Certainly, stone disease may have hastened it, aggravated it, but he has an underlying medical problem also.
So because most likely, yes.
He had episode of rejection that may have perpetuated and led to deterioration of graft. And if it was antibody mediated rejection, that might as well play some role in the development of ureteric ischemia and stricture.
So probably his sir, graft dysfunction at the end, or his he is already reached the ESRD status was multifactorial probably. rejection.
Why did you think in terms of stricture when there was obvious cause of obstruction in terms of stone? Why?
So my thought process was that because he had difficult stent removal and they used laser to cut it, probably some injury to the ureteric orifice and secondary stones. Another thing is that the stones were like secondary stones. They were very smooth. They were not seen on the X-ray, and they were very soft stones like. So they appeared to me like secondary stone, which happened secondary to any obstruction, not the primary stones.
Could you see any narrowing in the dye study or in anti-grade URS?
Sir, I was not able to see. I was able to go up to the ureteric orifice because some stones were there. And I was able to pass a guide wire, and even the balloon dilatation was not much difficult.
Okay, right.
So this is how we managed this case. We'll go to the next case, sir. So this is 33-year-old female. She had uneventful right iliac fossa transplant. It was a non-stented ureteronasal cystostomy. Post-op day, she had a small collection, which you find in so many cases. It's not something abnormal. Her creatinine drop was adequate, and as usual, we removed the catheter on the fifth day. On 11th day, she came back to us with abdominal pain and creatinine of 1.3. And ultrasound revealed 6.5 centimeter collection in the right perivesical region with mild dilatation. So here is the patient presenting with mild pain. Creatinine is normal, small collection. There is no stent, there is no catheter. Georgie, sir, how will you proceed? Sir, George Abraham, sir. Sir is not there.
Dr. Georgie Abraham.
Yeah. Okay. Since there is some collection and the patient is symptomatic, and the creatinine is slowly rising up, there is no stent, I think we have to put ultrasound guided aspiration and retain that drain for some time and see it and follow up.
Okay. We did ultrasound guided aspiration. 130 ml fluid was sent for biochemical analysis, and it revealed urine. Anish Srivastav, sir.
Yes.
Sir, we just aspirated and preferred not to put in a drain. Were we right in that, or we should have put in a drain directly, sir?
No, I think this looks like a small leak, and I would do a good CT cystogram.
Okay.
And, you know, because if you do the ordinary cystogram X-ray based, then it may not reveal a small leak or some, you know, some dye going out. So with CT cystogram, you can see that. And this is probably looks like a small ischemic leak on the 11th day, 10th, 11th day, that sort, you know, in the early part of transplant. That is what, because you are saying this is urine. So we are, you know, practically convinced.
Sabni, sir.
Yes.
Sir, instead of doing a CT cystogram, we preferred that time to do a anti-grade puncture and put in a contrast to see how much is the leak. So would you like to defend this and say why did we not do
this dilemma and this service will always be there, whether to divert, whether to wait for some time, and whether to stent, allow this leak to settle down, and whether to give endoscopic management or to do definitive management. There are plus and negative points for both things. But over a period of years, what experience we have gathered, if at 2 weeks, if you see urinary leak, it is best to, without doing anything, just open and do repeat reimplantation.
Okay. But in this case, we were a bit different and we did an ultrasound guided puncture.
Yes.
This is the anti-grade dye study that you can see. I think all of us can appreciate a small leak there, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
So, Vikas, can I make a comment here?
Sir, please go ahead, sir.
So, this is what I was expecting. So, the moment I would see this kind of picture on the CT cystogram, I would straight away, I would differ from Dr. Sabdis here. I would put a PCN like what you have done, immediately take him for PCN, put a guide wire and put a stent. See, this was a non-stented anastomosis.
Correct.
Sir. And this is what we have, if you see the literature in it and in our own experience, this is what we have proposed, that very small, you know, areas of ischemia due to, you know, whatever reasons, they can be dealt with a routine DJ stent. So probably, I mean, if there was a stent put in here, and if you remove, say, around 14 days, probably this would have been. That is, I mean, that's how.
So that is probably this leak would have been avoided by.
Avoided, and I would put a stent. I would not explore this.
No. Correct, sir. So that is what was done. We were able to put in a stent, and there was a small perivesical collection which was aspirated. She was doing fine. The collection reappeared on 15 days. She was asymptomatic. DJ stent in place, creatinine 1.4. Output was 4.5 liter and there was no hydronephrosis. Sunil Shroff, sir, did I made a mistake by still not putting a drain?
I don't know if it made any difference, Vikas, to be honest. I think what you did is perfectly okay.
Okay.
Maybe you could have left a catheter also to give rest to the whole system for some time.
The catheter.
And that would have probably, you know, healed the area a little quicker. Okay. Maybe that's all I may have done. Okay. But, you know, retrospectively, you can always be wise. And sometimes you get away and sometimes you don't get away. And that should not necessarily decide your future course of action, is my personal view. But I may have just left a catheter for a little long.
Vikas, I saw your table in the second or third slide. The collection was noted on second or third post-operative day. Did you have the perigraph drain?
Sir, drain was not there, sir.
Perigraph drain on the first day. You did not put a drain while doing surgery?
No, sir. No, sir. Not in this case, sir.
No, sir. I appeared after drain removal.
Okay.
See, typically on 11th, 12th day, if you get collection, by the time the catheter is out, drain is out, everything is out. Usually patients are discharged, but they come with abdominal pain and the collection. So that's the collection which has appeared after the at the end of 10, 12 days. So which typically is because of the some little bit of ischemia at the lower end somewhere. And there is some necrosis which happens.
Can a tiny leak be managed with periurethral catheter alone?
Sir,
usually it is not. But if you, some tiny leak in some cases can be managed by the catheter and the DJ. But over a period of years, we have realized that for that one or two cases to be successful, you are actually failed in many cases where you are just delaying everything and eventually you need the exploration.
Definitely small leaks can be managed by putting a periurethral catheter if the stent is already in place.
Yes.
If the stent is not in place, then definitely only periurethral catheter has no role.
I mean, the conclusion is the same, Vikas.
Correct,
what Kamnish has said.
So
what you are seeing is that if the leak has appeared on the 11th day, in spite of the stent position, then it has a completely different angle.
Right, sir. So she had again a small collection. So this time we were little wiser and we definitely put in a pigtail catheter. And over a period of time, the drain came as normal. The catheter was removed, the pigtail was removed, and she has been doing well after that, sir. So this is the case we were able to manage by just anti-grade DJ stunting on 11th post-operative day, as Dr. Anish Srivastava correctly said. We go to the next case, sir.
Vikas, Dr. Firoz wanted to say something.
Sir, please.
No. In this case, obviously what you've done has paid off, but I would have to agree with Ravi. If you got a collection on the 10th or 11th day, and especially that nephrostomogram which you have done, it doesn't show a leak from the anastomosis. It is showing a leak from the ureter a little higher up, 1 centimeter above the anastomosis, which means there is an element of ischemia in the lower ureter. To try and resolve that permanently using just minimally invasive treatments, the chances of long-term success are smaller if you have a segment of ureter which is ischemic. And it is generally very easily and successfully repaired with open surgery. If you go back in, there is very little morbidity and your long-term results are close to 100%.
Sir, ureteric leak,
very down at the anastomosis, these are ideal for minimally invasive procedures. But leaks coming from the ureter itself, where there is evidence of ischemia, I'm not sure that minimally invasive would be the first choice, sir. So obviously, it will work in some cases.
Because I would just add that if the leak has come quite early, so then yes, minimally invasive will work. But if leak has come at the end of 2 weeks, which was not there before, then those are the things. Because if it is early, then you can attribute it to improper healing or whatever, some high pressure in the bladder or something like that. But if it has come, everything has settled down, and if it comes at the end of 2 weeks, then something is... but anyway, you have managed it quite well.
Vikas, can I respond to...
Sir, please.
Yeah, so I agree with both of you. And I would say that if a leak comes, you know, on the second day, third day or fourth day, those are the cases I would not like to do with a minimally invasive. Because that means they are, you know, real big areas of ischemia. If it comes little later, like in this case, they are usually small, and we have shown it with the good dye study. And, you know, so that's why probably but minimally invasive treatment must be given for these patients. I agree. If this was on the second day, third day, fourth day, I would have straight away explored. Then I would say that's a bigger area, bigger chunk of ischemic thing, which will not respond to simple stenting.
Okay, sir. Next case, sir. This is 48-year-old autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease patient. He had living donor renal transplant in March 2017. Donor was wife. Nadi creatinine was 1.13 milligram per deciliter. In May 2017, he presented with asymptomatic rise in serum creatinine of 1.88 milligram per deciliter. As we, all of us will agree, the first thing that we want to have is an ultrasound Doppler. So this is an ultrasound Doppler which showed mild dilatation of kidney, sir. As Shraf sir really pointed out that this was on full bladder, and after post-void, this is the picture on the right side, sir. So we, sir, that makes a point that we should always repeat an ultrasound with the empty bladder. Do you agree to that, sir? Shraf sir. Dr. Sunil Shraf sir.
I think he is not there.
He's not there. Sir, so should we always repeat an ultrasound with post-void, in the post-void state?
I think theoretically it is a good idea, but in practice, I have very rarely seen reflux causing renal damage like this, what we are suspecting.
Yes, yes. That is what I wanted to highlight by asking this, sir. What is the role of reflux in recurrent UTI or graft damage? Anybody would like to respond to that, sir?
Okay, Dr. Sabnis, please go ahead.
Dr. Sabnis, sir, please tell
you. Yeah, Vikas, this is an important point that you must always do ultrasound at the empty bladder so that you know whether there is any full bladder, there will always be some hydronephrosis. And as such, also in transplant kidney, because they are very low and very near to the bladder, there is a hydronephrosis always there. Reflux generally does not cause major problem because these are all short ureters, and therefore the tunnel may not be adequate, but reflux does not cause such a major problem like what you see in the normal kidneys. So I would not attribute that everything is related to the reflux and that whole problem is because of that.
Sir, I had a look at the further pictures of ultrasound and showed that the ureter was dilated to the lower end. So definitely, this did not appear to be a normal variant of physiological hydronephrosis in the transplant setting to me, because the ureter was quite dilated up to the lower end.
So reflux must be there, definitely.
So this patient, till this point of time, was with nephrologist they are in habit of doing some investigations like a DTPA scan, sir. Anish Srivastav, sir. So what is the role of a DTPA scan in the diagnosis of obstruction in a transplanted kidney, sir?
Yeah, I think at this point of time, this is 2.5 months after transplant.
Sir, it's been September to, yes, more than 3 months, sir.
More than 3 months. So yeah, at this time, where if the system is full and, I mean, there is mild hydroureteronephrosis along with rise in creatinine. If there was no rise in creatinine, we could have attributed it to reflux, which happens in, you know, most of these kidneys. So here, it is important to do a good diuretic venogram. Yes,
sir,
I would agree with that.
Vikas, his GFR is 17.92 ml per minute at so, this low GFR, will this DTPA scan be reliable for commenting upon obstruction?
Anish sir, what's your answer to that question, sir?
It is a low GFR, but the point is that we have come to know about this GFR after doing the diuretic scan.
Okay.
Earlier, the patient was having normal creatinine or near normal, then slowly it started rising.
Yes, sir.
So I would not expect in a kidney with a normal creatinine and which has slowly started rising, a GFR of 17.92. So my point is that, you know, you have detected it after doing the perfusion scan, and then we have to think about the cause. To begin with, we have to go for it.
Sir, so how much importance you will give it now, the scan?
Yes, I would agree with now with this question that, you know, that if now the GFR is low, as is shown here, because what I was responding to earlier is the approach to the patient.
Correct.
Now you have done that, and now we need to respond to this second issue. Yes, with a low GFR, now as Ajay rightly pointed out, we need to look at it, you know, with a degree of caution that in a patient who has lower GFR, whether our even well-done diuretic urogram is very representative.
So how will you proceed now, sir, from here?
Yes, so now the issue is that we are in a position where there is a lower GFR, and we are not able to decide whether, you know, the obstruction exists or not. So I think I would do a PCN in this setting because creatinine is rising, and I'll get more answers after doing a good PCN. Yeah.
Sabni sir, are you dealing with obstruction here or something else?
What is the creatinine now?
Sir, 1.94, sir.
1.9 from nadir of
1.14, sir.
1.1. So I think in this case, there is an adequate evidence that on empty bladder, the kidneys collapse. There is no hydronephrosis. On full bladder, there is ureter is dilated. The DTPA is, of course, very low. This GFR may not be acceptable with creatinine. But I would not now entertain diagnosis of obstruction. We can do MCU just to document that there is a proper reflux, because everything is going into the reflux. And the rise in creatinine may be because of the medical reason, other than attributing it to the obstruction or the reflux, because there is no evidence of any urinary tract infection or sepsis or anything. So I would attribute it to the medical cause and do some biopsy or something after documenting that it is MCU showing reflux.
Georgie Abraham sir and Firoz sir, difference in opinion. How do you see it as an obstruction or something else?
No, I fully agree with that. We'll have to do a rule out a reflux by an MCU. Then we may have to take a renal biopsy and then proceed according to that.
Could this be bladder outlet obstruction?
I think that would be very clear, even pre-existing. If you have an asymptomatic patient and the sonography is showing minimal postoid residue, chances of bladder outlet obstruction causing this are remote.
Because the hydronephrosis has collapsed after catheterization.
Sir, after empty bladder, not catheterization. After inverted wells.
Okay. Here you have a patient with no clear evidence of obstruction. Postoid, the kidney is collapsed on the sonography. The renogram, which admittedly is not so reliable, is not showing any evidence of obstruction. There is a good possibility that there are medical reasons behind this, and we should hunt them down first.
Okay.
So Vikas, I think I missed that point that, you know, that it collapsed and everything was normal, you know, on a empty bladder. So yes. I think in that case, we should keep, and looking at this picture, we should keep the possibility of obstruction lower down. And probably a good Doppler also should be done besides thinking about a biopsy.
Sir, Doppler findings were normal.
I think I would agree with going ahead with the biopsy.
Sir, as all of you, I agree with all of you that even I did not have a doubt of obstruction in this kidney. And I was trying to convince my nephrologist to do a biopsy rather than me to intervene for possible obstruction. But as I had to, you know, As soon as they started doing a biopsy, they again called me and said, no, it is obstruction, you have to do something. And so many times you have to, you know,
bow down to
them. Say, and the same time we planned for the biopsy as well as to rule out obstruction. So I did an anti-grade dye study that time. And contrast was seen entering the bladder. Probably the obstruction was noted. The guide wire could be passed easily without any problem. And I did a DJ, gentle dilatation, and put in a DJ. And with the from retrograde, I was able to pass both the 10 French catheter, 10 French Teflon dilator, and 12 French Teflon dilator. After this intervention, the creatinine came down to 1.58. So they were again this thing that it was obstruction and not any medical problem. So what's your take at this point of time, sir? The creatinine has come down from 1.94 to 1.58.
So did they do biopsy or not?
So they did not do biopsy.
They deferred biopsy.
Yeah, they deferred biopsy saying that the creatinine has come down. Now it is coming down, sir.
I think this may be completely fallacious.
Correct, sir.
Because your antigrade is not showing anything. Your wire went easily. Dilators went easily. I don't think there is any obstruction like that. So even if the 1.58 is not a remarkable reduction in the from 1.9 to 1.6 is not that much of a reduction in the creatinine. Eventually, once the creatinine is 5.8, it is also not normal. So with the DJ in place, they have to do biopsy to understand what exactly is the problem. Now you have to convince that now obstruction is taken care of. Now creatinine is not coming down. So you do biopsy. Because nephrologists are always reluctant. They will always try to find out that is a urological problem in the post-operative.
And as soon as they see hydronephrosis, they usually send the patient to...
It is there. It is always...
So I try to convince them, but ultimately the time convinced them. After 3 weeks, the patient again came with a serum creatinine rising up to 1.8. This time there was no hydronephrosis. The DJ stent was placed. He underwent a graft biopsy, which showed ACR, pulse steroid was given, the creatinine started coming down, and it was reached around 1.28 milligram per deciliter. Sorry, any take-home message, Georgie?
Sir,
tell me.
Yeah,
sir.
Go ahead, sir.
Vikas, sorry, I dropped out of the case for 10 minutes and then I come back. You know, one of the key is, you know, in any transplant program, that there has to be a trust factor between the nephrologist and the surgeon. And if that trust is missing, you'll always have these challenges of, you know, they being reluctant and pushing something to you and so on. And we are always as surgeons, you know, at the receiving end, most of the times with the nephrologist. And sometimes we do things in favor of the nephrologist because we don't want their wrath from them, you know, because the way they sometimes behave. So in any long-term transplant, success of a program is highly dependent on who are your colleagues. So if you are starting a transplant, any of the youngsters, choose your colleagues, you know, with little caution and make sure you're compatible with each other. That is the bottom line of this program in India. I find this distrust all in most of the places. And that's why sometimes we get into these kind of situations. Sorry, carry on.
Sir, I'm with my nephrologist for the last 8 years and we have really good trust with each other. But Rappo, this is one of those cases where I was not able to convince her because there was a significant hydroureter nephrosis.
So the take-home message from this case is that nephrologists can never get convinced.
Correct, sir. Ultimately, that is the situation. And this patient had to ultimately undergo...
One thing when you go abroad and get trained, you know, even the nephrologist, the threshold for doing a biopsy is very low in the nephrologists who have worked abroad, you know. I do remember in my unit where I used to work in England, the biopsy used to be so more frequent than it is in India. You know, so the threshold of biopsy in India is much lower, believe me. I mean, much, you know, they're very reluctant to do biopsy. Unless they're pushed.
Sir, we'll go on to the next case. This is 27-year-old male, underwent renal transplant in June 2017. Donor was mother. It was a single renal artery and vein, adequate ureteral length. After applying the hemolope first clip on the artery, there was a malfunction. It did not work at all. Actually, it broke. It was a local made, not a original hemolope applicator. So I was able to apply only one clip. So to be on the safer side, on the donor side, I applied two LT400 clips. In the bargain, I lost an significant length of the renal artery, which was single renal artery, and ultimately I ended up in having two renal arteries, One is the main renal artery and the other pole is the lower polar artery, sir. And it was an stentic anastomosis and good brisk urine output, sir. Sir, so one quick comment on hemolog applicator, Dr. Anish Srivastav, sir.
Well, this kind of, I would say, an accident, we have not come across. Okay. The clip, was it the clip broke into two pieces or the applicator was not
applicator
applied?
At the angle where the clip is applied, that was actually loose. It was not getting closed at all.
So that's where the important message is to check before we use exactly. them. So and probably we could have avoided that. But
could have been avoided. It definitely it was an avoidable complication with a good surgical instruments, good quality surgical instruments. This could have been avoided.
And preoperative checking actually, for all these things.
Sir, preoperative it was fine, sir, because I was able to apply one clip.
Okay.
After and one then, clip, it did not. So nadi creatinine was 1.2 discharged. He came back with a elevated serum creatinine and gave a vague history that he has not been drinking well. And the nephrologist reported that he had a dehydration. So with that, he hydrated the patient, admitted TAC levels were normal. But still, even with good hydration, the creatinine was going up and it was around 5.5 milligram per deciliter. Georgie, sir, you would like to have an ultrasound at this point of time, correct? Sir, it's not there. Firoz, sir.
He's there.
I think definitely in this you need a good sonography and color Doppler.
Okay. So sonography showed that the graft two cut biopsy was planned and same time we did the ultrasound as well, which the moderate graft hydronephrosis. However, there was no perfusion at the lower pole. So graft biopsy was done, which was given to be as inconclusive. So do you think it was taken from a lower pole, sir, and did not show any findings? Dr. Firoz, sir?
I think with this with his history of what happened during the surgery and what you are finding now, there is very like all likelihood that that lower pole artery, which was transected and anastomosed to inferior epigastric, you now got a problem there, possibly a thrombosis. The problem is that it is likely to jeopardize the ureter also.
Okay.
Vikas.
Sir.
One important thing is that the fact that you anastomosed the lower polar artery to inferior epigastric, it should have been a small one.
Yes.
If it must be having a caliber of 2.5.
It was matched to the caliber of the inferior epigastric.
So then I would not expect such a rise in serum creatinine, even if a portion of say 10% or maybe 12-15% of the lower pole, usually it should be less than 10%.
So you don't expect, you expect that there's something else which is...
Yes, so I would say something else is going on. So I would... So of course, I mean, this is one finding, but this does not explain the kind of rise in creatinine which we are getting here. That's my point.
So how do you proceed, sir?
If on the sonography, you are seeing no perfusion on a large part of the kidney, looking at the whole lower pole, that means you're not dealing with a small patch. And second is if there is a compromise to the ureter, then there is likely to be an element of ischemic stenosis or obstruction, which can also affect the function of the rest of the kidney.
Sir, how will...
Vikas, there is a significant hydronephrosis?
Yes, there is significant hydronephrosis.
Along with the upward perfusion of the lower pole.
Exactly. These are the findings on ultrasound. Sir, rest of the kidney...
Why don't you put a PCN?
Correct.
Whatever is the graft biopsy or anything, you should put PCN.
Sir, that is what was done, sir. PCN. And this is the moderate graft hydronephrosis with hold up at the level of lower ureter. With DJ stent was still there. So lower ureteric segment was dilated anteriorly using Teflon dilators up to 6 French and 8 French dilator could not be passed. We were able to pass a guide wire into the bladder and we placed another DJ. So Shroff, sir, did I do the right thing or?
Because pardon me, I may have missed something. Now you have two DJs, is it?
Yeah. So you have done the same thing. Putting in another DJ was helpful, or I just bought.
So you are dealing with, I think this is 21 days or 25 days or something, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So you are dealing with an ischemic segment, you know, whatever you do, you put DJs and so on. I don't think it's going to really work, you know, to be honest. I don't know what happened after that. You know, you'll unfold the story as we go along. But in the long term, you may need some definitive treatment of some sort. But, you know, what biopsy was inconclusive. That, again, you know, should be looked into. Maybe, you know, another biopsy may be done. Because the question is, by, you know, at this stage, if the creatinine is not going to come down, even if you do a definitive procedure, are you going to salvage this kidney or not? That's the key we need to ask. If the creatinine is at 5.8 and the creatinine doesn't come down, then really, you know, we may not do too much good to this kidney by even salvaging this procedure.
How much creatinine come down with PCN?
Sir,
yeah.
I think the baseline 1.2, sir.
Point something. So
if, huh?
1.2, sir.
1.2.
Yeah, then you should do a definitive procedure.
Because I have two questions here.
Sir,
we are dealing with two problems. There is compromise to the artery of the kidney. At least one of the arteries is compromised, and that
poor oral artery is compromised. I agree.
Probably acutely, he has come with a sudden jump in creatinine.
Yes,
so
sir.
Why did you not evaluate the artery? Second, what did you achieve by putting in two stents when there is a stricture of the ureter with the existing stent? One more stent is, in my opinion, of
you know, the urine doesn't actually pass through the stent, it passes by the side of the stent usually.
So when you have a stricture in spite of stent, what are you going to achieve by putting in one more stent?
Sir, it is just that at that point of time, the guide wire could be passed easily, and I dilated it to 6 friends. So just the thought process, I did not have the previous experience of putting 2 DJ stent, it was just at that moment I thought I would pass one DJ. Probably the stricture will dilate and I may avoid a major surgical exploration.
Actually, while you're putting while putting the second antegrade also, there's a chance of the first one stent also slipping down, you know.
Down. This is what has happened here also. You can see as that is gone down a bit, sir.
Yeah.
Maybe, as you correctly said, that was not a correct decision to do. But since the thought process was that by putting a DJ, I may be able to dilate the stricture a bit and avoid a major surgical exploration. So I just did it. But as you must have perceived that I was wrong in my assessment at that point of time. Ultimately, this patient had to undergo a surgical exploration. We had to do a graft pelvis to native ureter uterostomy, and ultimately he did well after that.
Actually, sometimes, you know, these kind of explorations also not very easy to undertake in that area because there's so much of fibrosis. But
correct.
Of course, you did it around, you know, maybe 3 weeks to 4 weeks. But as time passes, it becomes more difficult to actually do any dissection in that area.
Correct, sir.
Okay, Dr. Vikas.
Sometimes the tip is that especially with the graft lower pole getting necrose and thrombose and things like that, sometimes it is very difficult to identify. So you have to put a stent in the ureter to identify where exactly is ureter. And you may have to go transperitoneal to find.
And not only that, I go transvesical.
Then dissect it out the lower ureter and get anastomosis.
The trick here is also to go transvesical and keep pressing it up. You know.
Sir, but one thing is very clear.
Do any of the experts feel that his angiography should have been done in view of under-perfused or non-perfused lower half of the
kidney? That is gone now, you know, 3 weeks, believe me.
Sir, the rest of the kidney was very well perfused. Only the lower pole small segment was not very perfused. And doing an angiography with a creatinine of 5, sir, that was not I don't think that was a correct thing to do. And after putting the PCN, the creatinine had come down to 1.2. Clearly saying that it is not a vascular issue, mainly the main renal artery is patent.
Vikas, you've shown us 2 cases of inferior epigastric artery episode at the moment, you know.
Sir, yes.
So we need to really review this inferior epigastric stuff.
Sir,
you know?
I regularly
used to use inferior epigastric artery, but to be honest, as time has passed, I'm a little bit reluctant now.
Yes, sir, this is over the experience of 12 years, 2 cases.
I know. I'm just joking. But I genuinely feel that inferior epigastric necessarily not always the best artery to use. You can use it in a young patient and you can get away. But as the patients get older, inferior epigastric quality goes down. And before actually I use inferior epigastric, I always, you know, open the inferior epigastric artery to see also how much of, you know, a flow is there in that artery, you know, and I'm sometimes even dilate the artery. I don't know if you guys do that, But, you know, to be honest, over the years, I actually slowly gave up inferior gastric artery.
Sir, this is my favorite anastomosis.
I know that. I know that many urologists love inferior gastric artery. Yeah. I do realize that.
With this, we come to the conclusion of this session. But from audience, there are three questions which need answers from the experts. So, Dr. Anish Srivastava, please tell us, if you take a diabetic donor, these are the questions from audience which need answer. If you take a diabetic donor, should you biopsy him before doing the donor nephrectomy?
See, actually, we don't take the diabetic donors at all, which I made very, very clear.
Okay, Mrinal, hey, you have
taken... Yes, maybe. Yeah, those who have taken that, I think they are the Mrinal, better...
Dr. Mrinal, you have taken that donor. Do you do biopsy? Should you do biopsy in a diabetic donor?
Sir, not necessarily. It will depend on the duration of the disease. When was the diabetes diagnosed? So in a recently diagnosed case, no much use of biopsy because nephropathy changes, they take some time before they develop.
Okay, so, very well answered. Very well answered. And Dr. Amit, there is a direct question to you. You had referred to intrarenal atherosclerosis. So how do you assess for intrarenal atherosclerosis in a renal artery stenosis donor?
No, in that study, what they did one renal artery biopsy and other is parenchymal biopsy. When we see the parenchymal biopsy, and then you can see the intralobar or the arteriosclerosis. And so that's why they suggested that we should not solely rely on the macro changes in the renal artery, but rather the better outcome prediction will be on the parenchymal biopsy.
So it has to be, so after retrieval, you do the biopsy, right?
But that study was for the cadaveric transplantation. Okay. So we have, for life-related, either DTPA renal scan will be a very good marker to understand that there is any parenchymal functional loss is there or not.
Okay. Because there is one question for you. Yes, sir. You have presented very beautiful cases of ureteric complications. So one member of the audience wants to know, when do you suspect BK virus ureteric strictures and how do you diagnose it?
Sir, the BK virus ureteric stricture, first of all, usually happens after 2 to 3 months. So anybody is presenting with a hydroureter nephrosis at the 3 months, we should keep BK virus as one of the differential diagnoses. And urine, definitely when the patient comes to us, the nephrologists have already sent the necessary investigation to rule out BK virus ureteric stricture. In my personal experience, I have not seen a single case of BK virus ureteric stricture.
Okay, right. So that concludes this case-based discussion. Now we have one presentation, small presentation from Dr. Anand Dharaskar at Pune. Intervention like percutaneous nephrostomy and anti-grade stenting. Anand, run it quickly.
Yeah.
While you are at it, because the same person has asked one more question. What are the precautions to be taken for reducing BK virus nephropathy? I think reduction of immunosuppression, but you are well positioned to answer that question.
That is what, sir. Sir, transplant is a net state of immunosuppression. More immunosuppression comes at the risk of infection. So you have to maintain a good immunosuppression, TAC levels to be monitored regularly. And as soon as the patient is graft function is stable, try to start reducing immunosuppression as early as possible. So
thank you very much, Vikas, for those wonderful.
It'll be interesting to know what is the incidence of BK virus now in India. Previously, you know, we never used to look at BK virus. Lately, you know, BK virus has become more and more a topic of discussion. So it may not be a bad idea to look at that in a little depth.
That is the one infection that causes surgical.
Yes. Issues. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Okay, Anand.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. This is the
last session.
Yeah, this is a quick story about the anti-grade access. This all happened during the COVID time. So I have some strong memories of that. 40-year female ESRD with hypertension. She was booked for the kidney transplant. The cadaveric graft was allotted on 21st of May. This was in the last lockdown. And the harvest center was a non-transplant one. So we were lucky to get a left-sided kidney with the good vessels. And this was placed on the right side. The standard induction immunosuppression was given. The creatinine dropped down to 0.7 on the post-op day. So it was all good, and we were happy that the cadaveric transplant is also behaving like a live one. The catheter was removed on day 5, drain was removed on day 8, patient was sent home. And the follow-up by the nephrologist, they reported that the creatinine started increasing. It's a 2.2 on the day 14. And our young nephrologist with the normal ultrasound did a biopsy the first. And it came out to be antibody-mediated rejection. So plasmapheresis was started. Patient responded well. Again, the creatinine showed the downward trend. And then by the time with the stent was also there, so we decided to remove the stent on day 23. And after that, 2 days after the stent removal, patient reported that there is some leakage from the wound site. And it was not very uncommon scenario, given the situation that the during plasmapheresis, the protein replacement is not very up to the mark because of the cost factor and other issues. So we always expect serous discharge. But this is the picture. If you can appreciate, there is a small opening in the lower end of the incision. And looking at that, we always put a catheter and see whether it subsides or not. But gradually, the drain increases to around 400-500 ml. So that we decided to make it clear whether it's a serum or urine. The drain creatinine, which we collected through the stoma bag, is 33 when the serum was just 0.8. So there was no doubt that it is urine. So we are not in a very much favor of doing a CT scan with a contrast. So we decided to go for a antegrade PCN here, the USG guidance. This is a we use a Cook micropuncture set. A small 21 gauge needle is used to do a small puncture in the USG guidance. Okay, through that the contrast first the urine is aspirated, then the contrast is instilled, and then the secondary puncture is taken with the 18 gauge needle. Even this can be converted into a secondary puncture because there are two different types of guide wires with the set, and this is the standard 0.35 guide wire going into the system. And here you can see, appreciate, this is the angiographic cannula, which is of 6 French, where you can have access to the system to put the contrast. These are commonly used by the cardiologists. And we're all doing this in the cath lab. So this access cannula is a permanent system in the pelvic calyceal system, where you can have a contrast. The guide wire is going across the ureter into the bladder. We decided to put a stent across it. 5 French by 16 centimeter stent were easily placed. Even after placing the stent, the access to the system is intact through this 6 French angiographic cannula. And through that, you again put a contrast and see whether the system is intact, the placement of DJ is as per your choice or not. And at the end, there is a stiff guide wire was exchanged, and the guide wire is then loaded with a pictel catheter. This is 8 French pictel. Instead of using a Mallicord, as I have seen in many cases today, our choice is the small 8 French, and we can see that it's very well placed in the pelvis. So this is how the antegrade PCN, nephrostomy, and then stent was done. So we were happy. This is just to enumerate what are the contents of the micropuncture set. Because the small needle is there, we can use it for a puncture and then exchange it with a guide wire, and then we can put a stent also. So leak stop after that. So when the PCN, we initially kept the PCN open, but gradually then we want PCN to be removed. So we stopped the PCN, close it, but then again find that there was a leak from the wound. So PCN was again kept open and the wound became immediately dry. So just waited. But even after waiting long enough, as you have seen that the surgery was done in the month of May, and this is now on the August, the leak was continuously going on. And even on PCN, the wound was not dry. We did antegrade study also that also showed leak. So immediately we took a decision for a open surgery. In fact, this is not immediate. It is almost 2 months after the surgery. This is the intraop picture, and there was quite a surprise to me. you can see that the net graft ureter quite a necrosis at the lower end with a cavity there. This is the picture. So this is one is the graft ureter with a necrosis, and it has converted into a cavity which was draining into the lower part of incision. And this is the native ureter. My choice is to do an end-to-end anastomosis of pyloureterostomy, native pyloureterostomy. So this was done. This is the last picture when the stent is going in. The urine output of the recipient was not much, like 400 or something. So we decided to ligate the ureter, make a good patulous native pyloureterostomy. So this was all done. But to our surprise, the problems were never at the end. And then again, during immediate post-op, there was a diuresis and the stent migrated down. So she also started leaking from the in immediate post-op, maybe after 2-3 hours. So we kept the PCN open for 10 days. And this is the picture of nephrostogram of 11th day of open surgery. You can see all the system is draining, but this stent was initially here when we had done the surgery, but with diuresis, this was immediately slipped down. But to my luck, this it was not gone beyond the anastomosis. So it helped the anastomosis to heal very well. The PCN was removed after 2 weeks and the stent removal was done after the 3 months of open surgery. We have waited long enough. And at the time of stent removal, this is the RGB picture. Cystoscopically, we cannulated the ureteric orifice, see whether there is any leak. It was well healed. We removed the stent and the creatinine is 1.1 on the follow-up. Thank you.
Anand, I have two quick questions for you.
Yes.
Your patient at the time of leak was not in sepsis. So why not straight away go in and repair everything and finish it off?
See, the leak was very small. You have seen that was a small
500 ml.
Yeah, then it started gradually. But it was a COVID time. We also don't want patient to kept to the theta with the G and all other. Minimal invasive procedures like stenting will definitely help if it is a small leak. So we decided with the family and the nephrologist to give a try for a stenting first. But it didn't work in this case. And you have seen that there is a necrosis and a cavity formation at the lower end. So that was the reason for it. In retrospect, we will always love to have early intervention in open method.
Okay. See, your stent had gone down, slipped down, and it must have kinked the ureter. Would that kinked ureter led to more problems rather than solving the problem? So, should you have removed it immediately?
In the second time, you are saying after open surgery?
Yes. Your stent had gone down and kinked the ureter.
It is still across the anastomosis and it was in the lower part of the net ureter. It helped a lot.
Okay, right. Thank you, Anand. So, Dr. Firoz, when you deal with such a case, when you go in for open reconstruction, what are the options of reconstructing a transplant ureter?
Basically, it depends on the length of ureter that is affected, but your three broad options are to re-implant the transplant ureter back into the bladder, which means redo your anastomosis. Second is to use the native ureter to anastomose either to the graft ureter or to the graft pelvis, or to bridge the gap using some kind of Bowari flap. The decision will depend on what is the length of graft ureter that is
available
and what you are repairing it for. If it is a very early leak, the first few days after the transplant surgery, often just redoing the ureteroneocystostomy is the best option. For late issues, either strictures, late leaks, I would usually not put the ureter back into the bladder. I would either use a Bowari flap or more preferentially use the native ureter. It's easier, cleaner, and you will get a better result.
Firoz, can you use a refluxing native ureter for transplant ureteric reconstruction?
If you are dealing with basic reflux disease, definitely not. If you are dealing with an incidental low-grade reflux in someone who has originally lost his kidneys for other medical reasons, then I would not hesitate to use a refluxing ureter. Actually, you would not know the status of this ureter when we take someone who has had a transplant for non-reflux disease. We don't normally check for reflux before reconstructing, in the sense that even when he comes in with a ureteric obstruction and we are planning to use the native ureter to reconstruct, I would not normally do an MCU to look for reflux before doing this. We would do reflexoscopy. We would put a retrograde catheter in that because that makes the native ureter easier to identify. Sometimes you have such dense adhesions that to hunt around for the native ureter is difficult. So putting the ureteric catheter helps. And at that point, you get a visual impression of the ureter.
Okay, right. Dr. Georgie, Professor Georgie Abraham, are you there? No. Yes, Professor Abraham, please tell us, when you are dealing with a case of urine leak post-transplant, what are the quick options, PCN, stent, or straight away explore? Which, when?
Always, when we do a transplant, we'll put the stent.
But you have a leak now.
In spite of stenting, leaking, then we'll have to retain the Foley's catheter for some time and see whether it will stop. If it is not stopping, then we may have to do anti-grade study or just see where is the leak and how to go ahead.
Okay. Dr. Sabnis, you mentioned that you have a very low threshold for re-exploration in urine leak. Please explain it to us.
Yeah, so this is exactly what I was trying to tell you, that the case which Ananda presented, this was a case where it would have, because of the COVID time, of course, they delayed it. So that is all right. But in a normal situation, when you have a leak which is appearing, especially post rejection and then requiring the plasmapheresis and things like that, and you have a leak which has appeared after 23 days of stent removal, we would have straight away gone ahead and done the definitive repair, rather than playing around. See, this is what we have, over a period of time, we have realized that, okay, you will be successful. Like Vikas was successful in one case. But when you are successful in one case, there are 10 cases where you will repent like this. It will get on prolonged. There will be episodes of UTI and eventually you will end up with exploration.
Right. Thank you very much. I agree with you, Dr. Sabnis. Dr. Anish, would you always put in a, okay, your practice is to always put in a stent. I want to know from, say, Dr. Shailesh Raina or Firoz, who usually do not put in a stent, would you always put a stent in a deceased donor kidney transplant?
I personally don't, even in deceased donor transplants, unless there is some problem with the bladder or the ureter. Shailesh always does it.
Even if the deceased donor kidney is showing no urine output, anuric at the end, would you still not put in a stent? Dry anastomosis.
Sorry, I know I'm going against the grain, but my practice has not been to put the stent. We've been doing this for almost 30 years now, and we've never really had a problem. My incidence of significant urological complications, both at Breach Candy, Jaslok, less than 1 or 2% without a routine stent.
Correct. I agree with you, and I have learned that from you only, Firoz. Thank you very much. Now, I request each stalwart, Dr. Sabnis, Dr. Georgie Abraham, Dr. Anish, and Dr. Firoz, to comment upon tips and tricks to do a rescue native ureter to graft pelvis anastomosis. Quick comments from each one of you, sir.
No, my first comment is that it is often difficult to identify the graft ureter as well as sometimes the native ureter. So if you have a PCN, it is better to put a ureteric catheter or something across just to identify. Also put a ureteric catheter to identify. If there are dense adhesions when you are trying to explore it, then it is better to go transperitoneal, identify the ureter, mobilize the ureter from there, and the ureteric catheter in the graft ureter will help to identify where exactly is a ureter, and that way you can do anastomosis.
Okay, Firoz.
I think Ravi has already summed it up. The main problem is the degree of fibrosis you find there. It is amazing how dense the fibrosis can be at times. It will make it very difficult to identify the pelvis or the graft ureter, native ureter. So you must try and cannulate those beforehand. That will make your surgery easier. Once you have got those, then generally the rest of your surgery becomes fairly straightforward.
Okay. Dr. Georgie, your comments on this, please.
You always will put a ureteric catheter in the native kidney for identification. We have to proceed with the transperitoneal, but extensive difficulty will occur because of the fibrosis of the transplant ureter. But we have to proceed according to that.
Right. Professor Anish.
Yeah, I think I agree with all the points mentioned here. Sometimes I have encountered extreme difficulties, all, you know, plastered. And so I would say that always a PCN should be there. Sometimes, you know, the PCN might have been removed or whatever, so that, you know, you can actually inflate the system. Sometimes it is very difficult to find, you know, where the pelvis is and all. So if you put a lot of water through the PCN or maybe within you, it helps in identifying. Just as another trick, I mean, in cases where there are lot of plastic.
There are two questions from the audience.
One more tip, that sometimes in spite of all these measures, I think Anish properly, rightly said, that we also do this, that you put a saline through the nephrostomy just to identify. And often we have used a fluoroscopy to find out, because everything looks like there is a ureteric catheter, there is a ureter. Everything is so fibrous and things like that. So often the fluoroscopy helps where exactly is the ureter, identify where exactly is the, because everything looks like a ureter and with the stent inside that. So putting a contrast or actually just simple fluoroscopy, identify where exactly the ureter, also can help in those situations.
Right.
Dr. Sabnis, there is a question from audience. Native ureter and graft pelvis, end-to-end anastomosis or end-to-side anastomosis?
It is from the native ureter, is always end to the pelvis. And you tie the upper ureter of the native.
And Dr. Firoz, in this rescue surgery, how long should the stent be kept?
I generally keep it about 3 weeks.
Okay. There is a question from audience. Can ultrasound be used to identify intraoperatively the graft pelvis?
Yes, you can. So that's what, to identify pelvis, either you put saline from PCN, you put ultrasound, any all these measures are required. Because it is sometimes difficult to identify where exactly the pelvis is.
Okay. Firoz, is it always necessary to tie the native ureter in this situation?
Tie the, you mean the upper end?
Cranial, yes, upper end.
That has been my practice, sir. You mean, can you leave it open?
No. What I mean to say is, the member who is asking is, without tying, can you do a end of the graft ureter to side of the native ureter anastomosis? That is one. And even while doing that, should you tie the native ureter cranially?
If you are tying the native ureter cranially, then there is no benefit to doing this end to side anastomosis. The only benefit of the end to side anastomosis is that theoretically you are worried about obstructing the native non-functioning kidneys. Generally, these are oliguric or anuric kidneys, so there is no issue. But even in someone who has a reasonable native output, if you ligate that ureter, most often you will never have a problem. So my practice in almost all the cases that I've done has been to tie off the lower end of the native kidney part of the ureter and use it as an end-to-side anastomosis. You will get a much better, much cleaner anastomosis, less chance of kinking, and less chance of leakage.
Ajay, but can I put one comment?
Yes, sir.
To that question which he has asked, generally the graft ureter is extremely difficult to mobilize. And therefore, it is hard to imagine that after, in the dense fibrosis, you will mobilize the graft ureter and then go to the native ureter and then do end-to-side anastomosis. Generally, it is the other way around, that you mobilize the native ureter, and wherever you find there is a graft ureter, you join, or a pelvis, you join there. And therefore, to mobilize that, you need to cut or ligate the upper ureter so that you can flip the ureter to where you can find the graft ureter or pelvis.
Thank you, sir. Firoz, recently we have discussed about transplant ureter getting entrapped into an inguinal hernia, and people are wanting to know your experience and how to deal with that.
In my whole life, I have seen only 3 cases of a hernia causing obstruction of the transplant ureter. 2 were very obvious. They came with high creatinine. There was an obstructed hernia and it was clear. 1 was actually a little puzzling. He came in with a high creatinine. He was admitted by the nephrologist. 24 hours later, his creatinine was back to normal. It was not sure what it was due to. He was discharged, sent home. A week later, he came back with oliguria and a high creatinine. And at that point, the examination showed the hernia. Presumption was that when he was admitted and laid in bed, the hernia may have reduced, creatinine came down, and we missed it on the initial examination. Diagnosis in all these cases is generally fairly easy. Question is how to do the repair. In these three cases, we have always preferred to do an open repair, extraperitoneally. I have a feeling that to go retroperitoneally would be much more challenging and would risk the transplant ureter. Whereas when you go in an anterior plane, like in open surgery, you can reduce the hernia without putting the transplant ureter at any risk. Generally, the hernia will not only compress the transplant ureter, but to a small extent, the transplant ureter may be drawn into the hernial sac. So that is always a risk you need to consider.
Then how do you protect such transplant ureters? Should you put a preoperative stent or ureter catheter?
Normally, if you're doing an open repair, you don't need that. These cases will be diagnosed mostly clinically, plus you will do a confirmatory CT scan. You will have the transplant ureter. You will be seeing how far it goes into this hernial sac. And generally, there is, it is more compression than the actual ureter. It is a short, rigid ureter. You see ureters getting pulled into hernial sacs in non-transplanted kidneys. But in transplant kidneys, the ureter is actually not so mobile. It is quite adherent. So it is more the hernia causing extrinsic compression on the ureter rather than dragging it into the sac.
Okay. One last question from the audience. Dr. Anish, if the patient has good native urine output and you need to do native ureter to graft pelvis anastomosis, and later on, how is the likelihood that this native kidney may develop symptoms, pyonephrosis, and end up requiring nephrectomy?
So in our large experience, quite a few cases, we have always tied it, like Dr. Firoz and Dr. Samir. I think everybody is tying it, and I don't think we have ever found any issues like infected hydronephrosis or need for the native nephrectomy. It's quite safe to tie.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, Ajay, just one comment. Even though those patients who have a good output pre-op, after successful transplant, generally that output drops.
Yes.
At native kidney, although they were pouring 500 or 1 liter of output, usually with a successful graft function, the output becomes almost negligible. And therefore, I don't think there's any risk in tying.
Yeah, I think that's the right explanation.
Thank you very much, sirs. So I think it's time to conclude. And I am really grateful to all the experts, all the faculties who have devoted their time on Sunday, prepared their cases, prepared their literature. I am extremely thankful. Nitesh, your final comments. Nitesh.
So we'd like to have comments from all the faculty, what they felt about the session. I think it was a wonderful session before we conclude. Sabnis, sir, your comments, please.
Yeah, it was, I think, extremely well-planned session. Focus on the ureteric reimplantation and its complications, as you rightly said in your introduction, is not much discussed. So focusing the cases on that aspect and having a detailed discussion, I think, would be very, very useful. Although, Ajay, you kept on calling us expert and expert, but I feel you are the expert and you have managed the session extremely well. So congratulations for the wonderful session.
Thank you, sir.
I would second that. Thank you, Ajay and Nitesh, for a very interesting session. I think I have learned more than I have spoken. Thank you again.
So Nitesh, it was really good. And thanks once again to have given us this opportunity. Very well done to all the faculty, young faculty. They prepared it very well. And Dr. Ajay carried it out in an excellent manner. Thank you.
Professor Georgie.
Yeah, I must congratulate Dr. Ajay for a well-organized scientific session, covered almost in detail about ureteric reimplant and other aspects. Congratulations once again.
So I conclude this meeting. Nitesh, thank you very much. I thank every faculty member and all the teachers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks. Thank you, Ajay. Bye-bye.
Hello.